G Money.
Yo,
what's up, man?
What kind of clap was that?
Just well, because you don't respond to love.
Oh my god, that's crazy.
How you doing? And I know you have something on your sleeve because the outfit looks too matchy. Yeah, oh, you got his no, yo. I get no money for the wait. How much you get? Why you don't share the money with me, bro? Did you write that?
No, it came with the package.
Really?
Yeah, I almost forgot it.
How are you, G Money?
I'm all right, sir.
We're back in the building.
Yes.
Today was a busy week.
Yes.
You pressed me outside last night and asked me what time the show was going to start.
And I should have came half an hour after.
And you stated you wanted to come at 11:10, and that was the
11:15.
Time. 11:15.
Yeah, and I was, and Michelle was outside there in the lobby, and I told her, I said, look what time it is.
Yeah, of course.
Yo, man, I'm just saying, I'm going to start showing up in this joint, like.
You know what's so crazy? When you come late, I just sit here. No, we got proof of you coming late more than three times.
Wow.
Proof.
We have proof. Eight years ago.
I documented it. No. Here. This studio. I documented it. And, you know, you come in here, but you do get straight to work. I would say that. Yeah, it fell. Yeah. But how was your day? I was, you know,
busy, you know, regular joint. DJ the school Zoom party today. Shout out to Challenge Prep.
I wanted to ask that. I haven't seen you DJing. What's up with the DJing outside? Like, what's going on with that? Have you took a break from DJing?
Nah, I mean people have been asking me if I'm still DJing because they haven't seen me like in the clubs or in Atlanta. That's where everyone's going now. Houston.
That's a fact.
I'm just not really with that right now. So I've been booked like every other week though, like every week pretty much doing private gigs. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So I'm still working. I might not post it up too much or nothing like that, but I'm definitely getting to the bag still. I'm definitely still working, staying busy. Just like not what you guys want to see on Instagram. So I don't really show that much. I'm just I go do my job, come back home. You know what I'm saying? So I'm still booking, doing birthday parties and doing weddings and you know corporate stuff and stuff on Zoom for schools and things like that. So you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, this is episode. We had our guest waiting.
Yo, man, shout out to this guest. Shout out to the sponsor. This is their third time actually sponsoring me. You know what I'm saying?
Oh,
they have a new brand. You know, shout out to Katie's Corner, KK Collection. They have a new brand. It's called Popular Loners. You know what I'm saying? Follow them on Instagram at Popular Loner _ brand on Instagram, man. At Popular Loners. At Popular Loner _ brand on Instagram. Shout out to them. Shout out to the whole KK Collection. Like I said, it's their third time sponsoring, you know what I'm saying? So they're getting comfortable, man. I'm getting comfortable. This outfit is a little comfortable. I ain't gonna lie. Got the sweats and the hoodie. I'll let you know, you know what I'm saying?
Yo, I want everybody to know I don't get no money from this. No, all just, I don't get, look, he puts it in his wallet and closes, yeah. And it's a Louis Vuitton wallet. I want y'all to know, I know y'all think that's a joke. I don't get any money from this. Look at me, none. Look.
Zilch.
But I'm happy that you're here. Shout out to Michelle. Shout out to Michelle, the producer of the other shows. You know, it's a long day today, man, but you know, she's getting to it.
Shout out Miss Jones. She
Michelle didn't talk about Michelle.
No.
Michelle took a picture by mistake of herself and it ended up on the YouTube for about 50 minutes.
Let's go.
No. But shout out to her, she's working hard. She's on time, and shout out to Michelle. Shout out to Sketch that's in the building as well.
Sketch, what up, Sketch?
I mean, shout out to everybody, but G Money!
Yo.
Wait.
Yeah, we had to update that.
G Money, hold on. You know where we at, right?
Yeah.
Episode 190.
Nigga, we made it.
We got a special guest. Yo. He didn't talk, so I didn't have to tell him to be quiet. He did chuckle.
He watches this.
And he's a professional.
Yes.
Hopefully he comments on our hospitality like everybody else does. Because you know there's rumors out there. My man! The man! Is he part of Hoodville? Is he the C? Hot Rod! Right of
applause. Yeah.
How you doing?
What up, man?
How you doing, man?
I'm good. How you doing?
I'm okay. I'm gonna fit the script, man. I like those glasses.
Oh, you know, I'll try to, you know, I don't usually wear these, but I'm on TV now or whatever you want to call it. But no, I do want to comment on the hospitality.
Oh, let's go, Bass.
Let me start it off by saying, who, Basky? Who's Bassy?
Bassy.
All right, Bassie. Now Bassie's a good person. Like, his communication is really, really on point. It was good. Like, everything was good. I was like, he was like, yeah, we're going to get the Uber. I'm like, nah, nigga, let me do the Uber so I can know where the guy is. And he was like, nah, I got you. And it was all good. It was like, it was perfect. Went to the hotel. Perfect. Hey, shout out to Basky.
Yeah,
was it Bassie?
Bassie, yeah.
I'm fucking his name up. So, yeah, Bassie, amazing. Amazing.
Thank you, bro. We appreciate that.
That's real talk.
He's 6'6". He's six.
That's it. 6'6".
Since the episode of that guy with the one eye.
Mm-hmm.
Since that episode, he's no actually 7'7".
I think that counts too. I just, you know, afterwards, I don't know what happened, but
yeah. Okay.
Yeah, we don't get.
Welcome to Flip the Script. G Money, you wanna?
Yes, we here, man. First of all, I wanna say thank you for being a. I don't want to say fan of the show, I guess you could say.
Definitely a fan.
Supporter, thank you.
Yeah.
You know, behind the scenes, he mentioned that he watched the show, he likes the show, and things like that. So it means a lot coming from people. You know what I'm saying? We got some guests up here who don't watch the show, which is fine also. But, you know, I'm very pleased when we have guests who watch the show. You know what I'm saying? It means a lot to us.
Yeah.
So we appreciate that.
And I just recently put two and two together that this nigga was the Annie Up nigga. I didn't realize
the
that.
Idiot.
I was like, wait a minute.
Yo,
so then I started going back to the
video. He came in here ready.
Because somebody sent me the Ray J video in the studio. Yeah,
he came in here shooting.
Yo,
today,
nigga, bro. I was crying. Nigga, I was crying.
He came in here shooting. He sounded like J.R. Smith when he walked in.
He's funny, man.
Is J.R. Smith.
Oh, man. Shout out to J.R. Smith, man.
Hey, yo, homie, you can sit right here, too. Look, if you want to sit in it, just right here in this bench. I see you out there looking.
Yeah.
Shout out to
that's the crazy Greek connect.
Shout out to the Greek connect.
That was good.
Yeah. But I appreciate that. Yeah, you know, my son, you know, you see how big he got. That was the one I slapped the cereal out of his hand.
Oh, that's him?
Yeah, JR. You know what I mean? Shit. Yeah. So, you know, you see, look how big he got. And, you know, but I appreciate the support.
Definitely.
I'm
trying to fire her, though.
Is that who you was talking about?
Yeah, I'm going to fire Michelle.
Why?
Ah, God, not you too.
What's happening? I mean, is it justified?
No. I just want to fire her. I just want to feel powerful. You're fired! I want her to walk out here sad. The music and all that. And say, G. Yo!
You
can talk now. Now you can talk. He came at you.
Damn, that was.
Don't talk to my Michelle like that, G.
Wow.
Psych, yeah, G. Yeah, but you know, we definitely appreciate you being here, man. Like, it's an honor, man. Like, you know, I just want to tell people, give people a little history as far as like, we interviewed Mike Knox, and he said something about you in that interview, and we can get into it a little later.
Yeah.
But and then you hit me up like, yo, Flip, bring me up. It was the perfect time.
It was perfect.
Like that. And I definitely want to get into that later, but I had to hand the torch off to my man G.
Nah, for sure.
Yeah, take it, catch it. Yeah, hold it.
Nah, but before we get into it, you know, I think the question people want to know, you know, where the hell has Hot Rod been at, man? Like, where you been at? What's been going on?
Man, I think that's like the whole, it's super weird because like, I haven't addressed it or, you know, the shit happened. I was hella famous for like a short period of time. Had sex with every girl I wanted to have sex with. Traveled the world. Did all this shit. And then it was just like, boop. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And then so like once all that like subsided, like, so I was signed in 2006. I don't know if I'm getting all that. Like, I don't know.
I just want to, like a general question. Like, where have you been at?
Just,
you know, because.
Yeah, just working. Like, you know, because I'm not just a, you know, I'm not like no, you know, street naked. I was just selling drugs and doing shit like that. Like, I was like, I'm a grown man with skills. So I just been, you know, working, went back to the, you know, to loans and making money there. Always working with artists.
Right.
Always recording and shit like that. But just wasn't on the scene. You know what I'm saying?
Gotcha.
And just recently, like, my Instagram started blowing up, you know, Good Times Jackson. And then, you know, just, I've always been, you know, just lurking,
mm-hmm.
but, you know, but just been kind of behind the scenes, just living life. You know what I'm saying?
Makes sense. All right, man. So, you know, also I noticed that, you know, I looked online and I didn't see too many interviews. So, you know, not too many interviews or none really, except for the ones from before with, you know, with 50 and things like that, with G-Unit.
Yeah.
Why is that? Is that by choice or?
Yeah, I mean, I just felt like, I mean, there's nothing to promote, and I wasn't really thinking about it, you know what I'm saying, until kind of recently. So like, you know, I forget who it was. Was it BET? They'd be like, "Where has Chingy been?" And they do like those little. So I started seeing those pop up, and I was like, "Wait, why these niggas hit me up?" You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm like, I ain't talked to nobody in hell long. And it wasn't like I was just signed to Capitol Records or, you know, or just signed to Ricky Jackson Records and Waffles. Like, I was signed to 50 Cent, like, to G-Unit. Like, it was a thing,
yeah.
You know? So, I don't know. People could have been reaching out or whatever, but I think now, like, everything's perfect. Like, it always, timing's right.
Timing is everything.
Yeah, like, I'm older, more seasoned, you know what I'm saying? And gotcha. I think this is actually the perfect podcast to be on it because, like, it's, like, fun. Y'all cool, y'all chill.
Oh,
it's man. Not like a, yo, it's not like a, like, no, get me wrong. Now, I would
G,
do.
G, don't hype him.
Yo.
Gee,
hey.
You can't like somebody that
crazy. He said a lot of keywords just now.
Like, no, G, but I saw it.
He said some keywords there.
Come on, man.
Wow.
You got to work for that, man.
Yeah, work for that. All right. You'll leverage a little bit.
But
man.
Look, we got to keep it 1,000. But oh, like.
Ignore that. He just trying to answer.
All right, just.
So. Now, don't get me. Now, obviously, I would do a Vlad, you know what I'm saying? But it's not like a Vlad, you know what I'm saying? Like a everybody calling the police and all. I don't believe that. But that's a whole nother thing. But like personality wise, like this. I'm happy this is like the one I can come out and be cool and comfortable with. And I already watch y'all niggas. So it's like an honor. And it's just a whole bunch of layers to it.
That's what's up.
Thank you, man. We appreciate that.
Yeah.
All right. So let's jump into it, man. You know, you've seen this show. So we're going to go back, you know, and, you know, take us back before Hot Rod. Take us back before the deals and, you know, the TV stuff, the tour and, you know, before everything. You know, where you from?
So I'm from Sacramento. So Sacramento, California. That was one of, like, the mix-ups because when I got signed, I was living in Phoenix, Arizona.
So that's what people were saying, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, so that was, like, one of the, like, weird mix-ups, you know, we'll kind of get into that. But from Sacramento, you know, grew up in the church, like all black people. Music, my pops was, like, a music director and all that. And so I was always around music. So just grew up, like, I was always, like, behind the music side of it, right? I wasn't always like a rapper. I mean, you know, I rap for fun, but I was always like, I wanted to be a producer. You know what I'm saying? So that's how I really got into it, being a producer, right? So, like, growing up, obviously, grew up in the hood, shout out to the Strawberry Manors, Del Paso Heights. About 17, moved out, and I was producing, right? So I'm doing, producing music for like some of the local artists out there in Sac. Now all these niggas was whack, right? So I got all these.
Oh, man.
I got
on. All these. They probably gonna watch this though, man.
This is a minute ago. They probably, I don't know what they doing, but here's the thing. And not saying Sack niggas was whack, but the niggas that I was producing for was whack. So we got all these hood niggas come to the house. That was bad, you know, bad decisions. But they was all whack, and so I got frustrated. You know what I'm saying? So I started rapping over my own beats because I knew what I wanted to sound like. So I started doing that. Now, while I was doing that, what happened was, like, everyone started giving me the attention, like, hey, you're hella tight at rapping, you're this and that, you know, basically, like, jacking me off, like, you're a great rapper, you should rap, like, you just need to rap. So I was like, you know what, that's a good idea, because, you know, they feed my ego, you know what I'm saying? So I was like, all right, cool, so, all right, fuck it, let me rap. So I built the production team. Right, so I built a team, probably like 15 producers, just for them to make the beats, so I didn't have to make the beats and rap, because that was too exhausting. Right, so I made a demo, you know, based off of, so it was demos and mixtapes I was making.
All right, hold on, my fault, bro.
Exactly, I was waiting for you to stop him.
I know, I was trying to see where you're gonna go. We, you know what I'm saying?
To stop him, G.
We don't want to speed too much. We want to get a speed ticket. How you say it?
Yeah.
However you say it.
Yeah, I felt like I was getting weird. Like, it was, like, kind of going all over the place. So, you know.
Nah, that's all good. Yeah, we want
to. We go back to the childhood.
Let's go back to the childhood a little bit more.
Yeah. But before we. Yeah, yeah,
yeah. We want to know about Sacramento. We from New York City. So, yeah. What was it like growing up in Sacramento? Like,
Sacramento. Sacramento, where I go.
So, Sac. All right, so, you know, Sac is north, you know, northern Cali. So, Sac, like, Sac's not the Bay. Right, like, people like think it's the Bay, or
how far is it from the Bay?
But like 30 minutes from
Oakland. Oh, it's right there. Okay.
You know what I'm saying? Or like a 45 minutes from San Francisco. Mm. So SAC was, I couldn't wait to get out of SAC because it was fucking, you know, a lot of the Bay niggas would come to SAC, right? And then hood it out. So then when you go outside, everyone thinks you the hood niggas. And then they, you know, they be like, oh, nah, you can't get in here. You know, you gonna come in here and start fighting and shooting niggas. You know what I'm saying? So it was very frustrating, you know what I'm saying, living in SAC and not being that, but being judged by how niggas was moving in SAC. Because, like, there's super hoods in SAC, you know what I'm saying? And then there's nice places, but you just, like niggas would get the short end of the stick, you know what I'm saying, just by other niggas, like, acting reckless in the streets and shit. There was, like,
so you grew up in the nice part of SAC?
No, I was in the horrible. My mom was a real nigga. You know what I'm saying? Rest in peace. She raised a real nigga. But it was like, yeah, I was surrounded by all that, but I didn't get into that.
Gotcha.
I didn't get into that, you know what I'm saying, to where it was like, you know, running around with guns and all that shit. But I was good because I was that nigga that grew up in the hood, you know what I'm saying?
What do you mean your mom was a real, like, did you live, first of all, how many siblings you had?
I have one older sister, and then I got some half brothers and sisters I don't really know like that.
So who was your father?
He left at, typical nigga story, he left at 7 or 8. But I saw him every other weekend, so he didn't just dip and then we had to go find a nigga, you know what I'm saying? Like, mm-hmm. I would go over there every other weekend, you know what I'm saying? He would do his thing. He was DJing and shit like that. You know, he'd give me $20, I'd go kick it, come back. He'd bring some hoes back from the club one night. I see him, you know, they step over my dead body and then... you know, not go back on Sunday. You know what I'm saying? Like, so he, but he was not, like I said, he, you know, when you get older, like you, like when you're little, you're like, man, this nigga really, but when you get older, you're like, oh, the relationship just didn't work. Or, you know what I'm saying? We tend to judge like situations when we're younger, you know, not knowing what the whole situation was.
Right.
So, you know, as I got older, I just realized, you know, him and my mom didn't work, but he was still there for the most part. You know what I'm saying?
So how did you view him back then, though, at that age, 7, 8 years old?
Facts.
Back then, I just thought he was just the cool, fun daddy that I used to see every other weekend. You know what I'm saying?
You didn't think too much into it. You just kind of...
Yeah. Now, early on, so there was one time we were at the mall, and so we're walking through the mall. And I would say we probably like 6, maybe like 7. And like when it first happened, we're walking through the mall. And look over, and we see this nigga with another family. And I remember looking, and that was hella weird. Right? We were like, what? What's happening? Like, what's... So I took offense to that, right? Because, you know, you see him with another little nigga, and you know, you're like, who is that? Like, what? Like, that? You gonna replace me, nigga? Like, what's happening? Yeah. So I remember that little short period of time was kind of... You know what I'm saying? But my mom's never oh, fuck that nigga. You know what I'm saying? She never really went in on him like that. So it never, like, festered as if he was a bad person. But seeing that was, like, the one weird time that I did feel, like, kind of in between.
So he had another family. He left and had another family.
Yeah, I don't know what that... I don't know. Maybe he was just blowing her back out and he would just end up at the mall. You know what I'm saying? Like,
Did you speak to him?
At the mall?
Yeah.
Nah. We just kept it pushing. I don't know if I'm like, we didn't say nothing, but I don't know what happened. I don't know if like we just kept walking or it was like we saw a ghost or something. It was just weird. It was like one of those weird what's happening, you know what I'm saying, moments, you know what I'm saying? So that was just the one time, to answer your question, like I felt a certain way about that, like seeing that in my face. But other than that, it was like, all right, this is.
But what did your mom do? Because you said she was a real, what was she doing?
I don't remember. She probably just looked over and was like, come on, y'all. Like, but no, she wasn't a real nigga. Like, she from Detroit and she going to pull a gun on her. What I mean.
What was mom doing? Like, what did mom do? Like, what was her occupation? Like, was she working? Was she?
Yeah, she worked for the post office. Yeah, she worked for the post office for like 100 years. But yeah, she just held it down. Like, you know, like, single mom, working, you know, you know, I'm sure there was hella shit going down behind the scenes, but it never got brought to our doorstep. You know what I'm saying? Like, to where it was like, you know, she was just real, like just a real strong black woman that just took care of the situation, you know. Like we was always good.
Did you ever see your father later on and have a conversation with him about, you know, when we get older, we have conversations with our parents and stuff. Did you ever have that conversation with him as far as why wasn't he there or let him know how you feel?
Nah, I never did. Never had that. But it was weird because when I got older, we got cool. But I never talked about that. It was weird. We were just cool. We were just like, just friends. Like, you know, because again, there was never any hard feelings.
Right.
I didn't think there was anything I needed to like heal from or anything. So yeah, I never like brought that up. And I'm the type of nigga to bring something like that up. You know what I'm saying? Like I'll talk about shit like that, but nah, I never talked about it.
Yeah, I mean, it's not like nothing really crazy happened. Like from what you're saying so far, like he didn't like disrespect her, put hands on her, anything like that. Or
oh no, and, definitely and, put and hands
she
on
didn't,
her.
She didn't really.
He put hands on her one time that I saw. Yeah, that was another time. Yeah, he put hands on her. I remember seeing that, and that was weird as fuck too. But that was right before
before the time in the mall.
Yeah, so I clearly suppressed that. Thank you for bringing that up. Mm. Yeah, that happened.
So how much siblings do you have? Steps do you have? How much kids did he have
on the side? Yeah. So I know there's a daughter. I have sister, and I think there's a little half nigga too. If I'm not mistaken,
he ain't shut that up. What he did is that he just closed himself out. You see what's going on here?
What you talking about?
You closed yourself out from that. That's what you did. Like so, because if you ain't go out there and look for them to be a one big family like some people may do, you just remove that section from your life.
But why? But I didn't. But you know that was the thing. So like we were talking about earlier. So. The whole love thing, like how you know how you can't say I love you. So the same thing, like so we didn't say I love you to each other, right? And I just thought that was normal, right? As a kid, and then so check this out. So we went to church one morning, I think it was Easter or something, and so we all sitting there. So I mean, so it's just me, my mom, my sister, and the pastor. You know, he's like, you know, he's spitting his bars and all that. He's like, yeah, you know what I'm saying, da da da. So he was like, all right, so this is what I want y'all to do. I want you to stand up. So, you know, we all stand up, you know what I'm saying, like a cult. Look to your left or look to your right. And I want you to hug that person and say, I love you. Right? So up to this point, like we've never, that just wasn't part of our family. Like we didn't do that. Nigga, I remember I turned around to my mom and I went, I love you. And like, went to hug her, and my whole body went numb. Hmm. And I remember as a kid going, this, like, what the fuck's happening right now? Like, what? And that's when everything clicked. It was like, nigga, like, you don't even, because you've seen everybody else like, oh, I love you. And they're all like kissing each other, you know what I'm saying? I'm like, and it was like one of those Saw moments, like Saw the movie, you know, you go, and I was like, oh my God, like, we've never done this. So it was like a breakthrough, like a weird, I was like, wow. And then it was like, all right, turn to the other motherfucker. And I looked at my sister. I was like, I love you. And we looked like fucking weird. And we hugged each other. And I was like, wow. Yeah, like you said, like you saying I love you was weird. Mm. It was weird. Like that's why I asked you, like, does your body go numb? That's what I was talking about. My whole body went numb. But that's because it's like a new act. Like your mind, your body doesn't know what the fuck's happening. So... I forgot why I was saying that.
No, because I said that you started to, you know, it's a deflection, but I'll bring you back to it.
Yeah.
You started to say, because I asked you, I said, why you didn't, you removed that from the side of your mind, because oh, why right. you didn't go, you said, I think there's a sister, and why you didn't look for that unity, or do you have, because you make it seem like everything is okay, but then when you speak, on the contrary, it looked like some sort of resentment a little bit that may be hidden, that you may not have tapped into.
That's why I brought it up, because we never had a sense of, there was a family thing, but it was never like, you know what I'm saying? Like, got oh, sure, I need to go find, you know, people are like, oh, I talked to my, it was never that. Like, I knew my parents loved me, and I knew, like, but we just never, it was never like the traditional, thing. So when I found that out, it was like, oh, okay, that's cool. That was just my raising. It was weird. And then, so then as I got older, right, then I started looking at my grandmother and all that. I was like, oh, that's where the whole family learned it from, right? Because my grandma, she was that way. She was hard. Now, she was hard, like a hard real nigga like type. And I was like, oh, because they're a product of her. Oh, right? So then it got to that point where I was like, oh, I got to break the, you know, I got
to
break that.
I was about to ask that. Do you never wanted to break the cycle?
Oh, I can't stop breaking the cycle. I'm a professional cycle breaker. So, like, that's literally what I do now. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, I'm super exaggerated. Like, I even know I talk to people about it. I'll be like, that's what, like, I'll tell people, like, you know, that's why I'm very forthcoming with, y'all rock with y'all. Because, you know, like, you know how niggas are. You know what I'm saying? They're like, oh, that's gay, nigga. Like, you going, like, what are you talking about? Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's super whack if you can't express your feelings. In my case, I couldn't, you know, I couldn't express it because I just didn't know it. But once I figured it all out, I'm making a conscious decision to be like, yo, I'll fuck with you. Yo, that's hella tight, nigga. That shirt, what we doing? Like, to really do that. Now, you know, like, even like Drink Champs, how they, oh, I don't know if we can bring it up.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
How they like, yo, I want to give you the flowers. Like, how they're kind of, they're breaking that little cycle. That's how I move around, like, just to be that. And people are so, they're not used to that. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Is your father still alive?
Yeah.
So that's how you spoke to him.
Shit. Maybe 3 years ago, maybe? Why you gotta put your head down?
Yo, you know what's so crazy, though? I'm gonna keep it 100.
Yeah.
And I'm gonna just say this respectfully, like, I respect, you know, what you stand for, but you still got some things to fix. My opinion.
What you think? What?
You still got some things to fix that you, not saying that you need to.
Okay.
You know what I mean? But what you preach.
Yeah.
What you just preach, which sounds good. You convinced me. I can see how you can get a deal and stuff. Yeah. You sound good, but then that is like a shield. That's a force field that covers your true emotions. Like, you're saying that you're doing all of that as far as approaching things and coming forth, but you didn't come forth to the person that you need to come forth to. You didn't have that conversation that you needed to have. Mm. So you sort of put that in your mind and you sort of used coming forth to others as a replacement, but you didn't do that who you need to have. Yo, dad, let me just talk to you and let that out, because that would be an emotional roller coaster for you, because you just stated that as a child hugging your mom and saying I love you made your body go numb. So imagine when you talk to Pops about, your Pops, I saw you. What happened?
Yeah.
Get that understanding from his perspective. Now, Pops may give you his perspective, or Pops may just be, but once you have that understanding, that'll put you, that's when you really unlock what you need to unlock.
Nigga, you just made hella sense.
That's pretty good.
Wow.
Seriously? Pretty. Pretty good.
Seriously?
Yeah, I like
nigga, that was amazing.
That was pretty good. I like that, man. That was good job.
Yeah, so I mean, that's happening. That's already happening now.
I appreciate I appreciate him. Like, I can see, you got to understand, you got to pay attention to mannerisms and read the room. Now, when you got into his childhood in the church, kept it moving. Then when you got a little deeper, he started to unlock things that he compartmentalized, and he put in his head. So he put it in a drawer. Mm. So then now when you open the drawers, now it's like, okay. And then when you ask him, because these things, he said that, yo, when I hugged my mother, my body went numb. But he still didn't approach that one thing, and his pops is still alive. Rest in peace to your mom. You see your mom pass away. Yeah, rest in peace to mom. Appreciate his pops is still alive. Mm. He still didn't approach that. By, yo, I saw you in the, like, what was up? Like, what happened? But he got that understanding, because Pops can give him that understanding of why he's alive and coherent.
That was good. I like that.
I appreciate that.
Wow. We've been here for a while. You did some dope stuff in the show. That one was pretty. That was just. You know?
And so, I take information. I appreciate that. Like, yeah. So I'm gonna keep you posted on it. I'm gonna hit.
I hope you really.
That was real.
I hope you really take the time out, because when you said even, you know, like how loving you are and show love, so it just threw me off when you said you ain't gonna find your brother and sister. You ain't gonna talk to them and even find out how they might have felt that pops did that. How they might, if y'all could share anything, like. Yo, did dad do this to you too, or have an understanding?
Yeah.
Because it has to go, it has to, when you represent something and you like that, a lot of times we go undone. We leave ourselves undone and try to heal others. But we unlock a character when we actually try to heal ourselves.
Right.
Unlock, now you could be, now it comes more genuine.
Right.
Because not saying you was a genuine, I'm like, hey, we over here talking, like, Hot Rod is cool as hell. Yeah. And now when you're talking, it's like, Hold on. You find your brother. You say I'm a little nigga somewhere. You find your brother and sister. Not to even share moments or understand, like,
right.
Your pops might have did that to your moms, or why you think pops did that to get a closure, and you'll see what it do.
Yeah.
Mark my words. Even if it comes out, even if pops say it in the way with, man, you too, you see the clarity that you would get.
Yeah. And I'm so another compartmentalized part. We unlocking the layers like an onion.
Yeah.
So I did. All right. So there's a moment where this is all coming together. So my mom was like the godmother of like some other kids, right? Because she was always outgoing. So I used to sit there and like, why is she showing them? Because she would say, I love you and all that shit to these little kids, to these little girls, right? So as a kid, I was just like, looking at that, I was like, what's happening? Like, what? This is hella weird, right? And there's one day, I don't know, she took him out shopping or some shit. Don't get me wrong, she's taking care of me too. She's not neglecting me, so I don't give that. But it was just a different, you know, type of thing. Kind of like how you, like, you're showing the love to others, you know what I'm saying? Like, and I remember it was one day, and I went in the shower, and I was like sitting there. And I think this is when that character began. Like it was like that, like with like trauma, right? You create that person to deal with, to be your bodyguard. Like you create a bouncer, you know what I'm saying, to protect the person that was hurt. So I never forget in that shower, it was kind of like that, like switch, like, man, fuck that shit. You know what I'm saying? Like, all right, cool, right? And that's what happened. I feel like that. So I did create that person that doesn't go seek out the brother or the sister, or it's like, nah, don't worry about that. I got you, because you don't want to know about any of that shit. You know what I'm saying? So there definitely was another person created.
I can tell.
Yeah. That's all right.
Is he cool now?
Damn.
I'll get all emotional with me.
This is amazing.
Hot.
Oh, no, I ain't there yet.
Yeah, hold it. I really hope, because, you know, people going to comment on this. I really hope that, you know, you take this and you know, and make it happen. Yeah. I would love to see that follow-up. Me. Like, all right, let me see what happened. Did Hot ever speak to them? Or did Hot, you know what I mean? I think that people would like that, because a lot of people do that. A lot of people are afraid. A lot of people don't aren't able to approach things. But when we see somebody that's also maybe on a higher level, but in the same, going through the same thing, it does something. Like, if he can do it, I can do it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? If he can go approach it, I can go approach it. And it's just going to bring closure. That's how I feel.
Yeah. That was good.
All right, let's move on, man.
I like that.
Man, yeah, I didn't know we was going. Yeah.
I like that. I like that a lot. I like that a lot. That was good.
Man. Yeah, G. Yeah. Chill. All right, man.
See, almost got a cool, man. I think he was right there.
Yo, this is where you're supposed to take a shot or something, man. What's happening? Oh, yeah. I take a shot. Cheers, man. Yeah.
To closure.
What are you drinking, J.R. Smith?
He don't want to tell me what he's drinking.
Is that plum juice?
It's mixed, it's berry and all that, just healthy stuff.
You get like a cleanse?
Nah, just trying to be a little healthy nowadays, you know what I'm saying?
Okay.
It says berries like juiced up together. The grapes and
I gotta read the thing. Blueberry. I forgot. But like blueberries and all that.
Boysen juice.
ain't nothing crazy in here, man.
G chill, G.
I'm trying to get back in the league, man. You know what I'm saying? I'm trying to get healthy to get back
in the
league.
So you had a dollar sign on top of it.
So I can know it's my bottle. Nobody wants to. You want to smell it? Or you think? What do you think is in here?
He got liquor in there, too.
Nah, I want you because you coughing. I don't know what's up with you say.
Oh, it's a lot of berries.
Yeah, see? You didn't trust me?
I'm cool.
Yo, all right, so
yeah,
we in Sac Town.
Sac, yep.
Growing up in Sac Town, you said a little crazy, but you chilling. Mm-hmm. Mom's holding down. You know, Pop's doing his thing. What's next for you? What was it like for you? I guess like in school. School, obviously. In school, you play sports, anything? Or?
Yeah. Play basketball, football. I mean, I was whack. I wasn't good.
I was about to say, were you any good? Or?
Yeah, and I was terrible. I looked cool, but it was like, I wasn't like the, you know what I'm saying? I wasn't the, you know, the nigga. Matt Barnes, like he went to high school up from, because he was in, he went to Del Campo.
Okay.
So that was like, so I knew like he was good, you know what I'm saying? Like Ontario, like, yeah, there was the good cast, but I was just on the team, like, you know.
Gotcha.
One of the extras. I was like a tax write-off. But so it was cool, you know. I was always like a cool nigga, you know, like we had the, you know, had the like the cool guys, you know what I'm saying? Like we dressed cool, like our slang would the whole school would talk like us. Like I had a good, you know, good high school years, you know what I'm saying?
Did you have any beef? Were you into like trying to like be in the streets, sell drugs, any of that? Did you ever go any of those routes or try to do those things or not? You was more on a narrow, straight and narrow path. It was like playing sports, passing class.
Yeah. It was, I didn't do that. Because again, like I said, my mom's a real nigga. Like, she wasn't having that. Like, I got my ass beat. You know what I'm saying? It was like, I couldn't go out and do, like, I saw that, but it was like, I had sense. Mm. You know, I didn't run amok in the house. Like, it was like, you know, it was like, I was scared of my mom. You know what I'm saying? Because she put it down. Like, what are you doing? Like, so it was never any of that.
What gangs was that? Was in the area at that time?
We say,
what gangs was in the area at that
gangs?
Time?
Gangs,
yeah.
So, I grew up in the Strawberry Manors, right? Mm. So that was the SMGs, it was the Sac Manor Gangsters, and actually the color was green, right? And right down the way is Del Paso Heights. That was the deepest part of hell, DPH. And don't get, there's shit, like, you, like, there was dead bodies and guns. We playing basketball. It was some real shit. Mm. But I never felt, but that was, you know, my place. You know what I'm saying? That was my home. So it was never like, it was just normal. You know what I'm saying? I just wasn't in it like that. You know what I'm saying? But, like, yeah, you know, there was a levee up the street. And, like, dead bodies. Cut a nigga dick off, put his mouth and shit. Like, it was crazy shit happening.
You saw that?
I didn't see it. That was just the
area.
Yeah, like right up the street, like walking, like used to walk to school over the bridge and like they had like the little levee or the little, you know what I'm saying? Like, there was all kind of shit going on, you know what I'm saying? Damn. And I'm sure I suppressed a lot of that too. But I wasn't a part of that.
Did you ever get robbed or anything? Like, did you have anything traumatic happen to you as a kid? Bullied, somebody tried to attack you, cut you, shoot you, fight you over a girl, nothing?
Mm-mm. I was like the nigga that played basketball and like, I was like the nerdy, cool. There was like, oh, you don't fuck with him. Like, he's just because I live right next to the park. Mm. So I would just go play hoops every day. And like, so I just knew everybody. Like, oh, you don't fuck with that nigga. Like, he ain't doing nothing.
Did you graduate from high school?
Yeah, of course.
You went to college?
Nah, I didn't do college.
What did you graduate with?
What my GPA?
Yeah.
I think it was like a 3.1. Low 3. But I had the mental capacity to get a fucking 1000.0, but I just barely got by because I was like over school. So like growing up, like my mom, she started me early, like at like 3 or something, like super early on, whatever the age, 2, 3. Mm-hmm. So I was always smarter than everybody. So I didn't have to really work, right? I just do it like.
You was bored in school, basically.
Huh?
So you was bored in school?
Yeah, I was bored. It's like they would give us like the little time. Remember times tests? Did y'all ever have? Like it would be like 50 problems. Mm-hmm. And they would go, all right, and they would start a timer like a minute.
Yeah.
And I would like finish it in like, I don't know, 20 seconds or something. And then the teacher would be looking at me and I'd be hella loud. You know, when you get bored, you just become a bad, you know, not a bad person, but you just become a bad student. You just start making jokes.
Combative, yeah.
Yeah. So second grade, so going into second, they wanted to put me up to fourth. Right, they're like, nah, this nigga's crazy. Like he, need to put him like in a. I was juice, right? I'm like, oh shit, that's hella tight. Like I'm a young nigga gonna be in fourth. And my mom, she said, I remember my mom. So we went to the school, and they were like, yeah, so we want to put this, you know, we want to put him in fourth grade and da da. And I was like, oh wow, she's, you know, she's gonna be so proud of me, da da. And she was like, nah. I was like, I'm looking at her. She was like, nah, he's not organized enough to do that. I don't think he'll succeed. And I was like, and I didn't know, but I really wasn't. Like, when I look back, because I'm still not organized, she was right. And I felt, like, at the time, I was like, why would you do that? But everything's perfect. Like, the way things go, everything always happens for a reason. Like, I wouldn't have met the friends that I have. And there's just a lot of good things, you know, that happened, like, reflecting back. Like, if I went to fourth grade, that wouldn't happen. So, it was the best choice. But my point is, I've been like super smart like my whole life.
I'm gonna get it. No.
You see
it,
right?
No. Not yet. So you out of school. Don't go to college.
Mm-mm.
What do you do out of school next? Because you don't go to college. You're not playing. You said you wasn't nice in ball. So
yeah, terrible.
Terrible in ball. What do you do next? After college.
All right.
After high school, sorry.
All right, so leading up to graduating, so my mom, say old school, you know, so my whole family was military, like my uncles,
mm-hmm.
post office, like get a job, go to military, or go to college, figure this shit out. So that's what my mom told me. She said, look, so, like, black parents, it's like, nigga, when you're 18, you get in the hell out of the house. So she was like, all right, so what, you know, you're going to either go to college or you're going to get a job at the post office or you're going to go to the military. And I was like, nah, I'm not doing any of that, right? And she was like, all right, well, you got to, you know, move out. I was like, yeah, I'm going to move out. So I moved out with my boys. So we'd already been talking about the music thing. Right, that's kind of leading into that.
Mm-hmm.
So I graduated in 99. And so mind you, this is like the Swiss Beats, you know what I'm saying? Rough Rider,
Rough Riders.
So that sound, like Swiss was a huge influence on me. Like I wanted to get the Korg, you know, the Trinity, the keyboard. And I used to go to Guitar Center and just make beats and shit all day and then, you know, couldn't afford it, so just leave with my little shady ass beat playing. But so we moved out. So I moved out at 17 and with my boys. And that first Christmas, we all put in and bought like a shady ass keyboard to start the thing. We bought a keyboard and we bought like a $100 mic, you know, little PC. And that kind of set off, we were going to start a group. And, you know, that set off the whole music thing. Now, mind you, this is 99, like 99, 2000. Like, I didn't even know how to, this is MP3. Like, well, what's it? I remember trying to drag an MP3 into the email and I'm trying to send the email and it wasn't going through. I remember like trying to figure this shit out, nigga. This is 99, nigga, 2000. So this is, so it was like, we were really in the trenches, like trying to figure this shit out. I forget when LimeWire and all that shit came out. I think that was around that same time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, LimeWire used to be it.
Yeah, so it was like, it was all that. So so that's what happened when I moved out. So we started doing that whole music thing. So that's when I'm recording with the, you know, I start making the beats and then I'm bringing the sack gangster niggas over and they're rapping their terrible raps over my mediocre beats. And that's what set off, you know, me starting to rap, mm-hmm. right?
I'm listening.
Now, I'm still responsible, you know. I had to pay the rent, you know, so got, you know, we're working. You know, first job I had is $9 an hour at this little shady, it was like a credit repair. It's probably like a Ponzi scheme now I look back at it, but
everything is shady to you. Everything is shady.
But it was
shady keyboard.
Shady keyboard. Now
but
shady.
It was shady. It was like $90. So here's kind of like the little turning point, right? So, like I said earlier, so I built a little. Y'all, how old are y'all?
I'm
33. 34. Oh, you're a child. Are you serious?
Born in 87.
Damn.
86. But you're not that much.
Well, yeah, I just don't feel like I'm older. That's why I didn't. Anyways.
How old are you?
39.
Yeah, you're not that much. You said a child. Like, I thought he was.
But I just don't feel that way. But anyways, no disrespect.
No. Come on, stop it.
I didn't mean it like that. But yeah, so now, y'all, so there's a site called SoundClick.
Okay.
Right? Where you can get beats and all that. So that's how I found all my producers. So remember, I was producing, but then everyone started jocking me over my raps. So then I was like, all right, cool. Let me just rap. Let me fall back on the beats. Let me find producers that make, you know, tight ass beats, and then have them feed me beats, and I can just focus on writing. So, started doing that. At that point, I'm like, I'm super good at this, right? And I was like, I'm gonna get signed. Like I feel it. Like I know something. I have a talent, you know what I'm saying? I know this is gonna happen. But I'm still working and shit like that, right? So Verizon, right? So I was always in customer service. So I get a job at Verizon. Now this is like, I think I'm 19 at this point. So, you know, I'm doing my thing there, you know, blah, blah, blah. I get promoted super quick, all this shit, right? So I'm making good money. See a little loophole in the system, right? So this nigga's face.
Oh man, I
this nigga's face.
I hear something crazy happening after that.
Oh yeah,
I hear some shady going on.
Shady,
super shady. So I see a little shady loophole in the system
because you're smart.
Yeah,
got it.
Let's go back to real quick. Let's take a time machine back to junior year, high school. Took a summer school class because there's a bunch of hoes that went to this one school. And so we was like, let's take summer school, you know what I'm saying? Like, so I took a computer class. This is 98. And they taught us about the internet and all that shit. So I was already gamed up from that summer. Like, I had, you know, just a little bit more knowledge than the average bear, you know what I'm saying? So fast forward. So I'm at, you know. I'm like, man, these niggas they not tracking this shit, right? They're not tracking these phones because I'm taking orders for resellers, and I'm like, they not tracking this shit. So I hit one of my boys up. I was like, hey, nigga, I'm gonna send you this phone. Tell me when you get it, and then let me see what happens. So I sent him this phone. It was like a $600 phone. He gets it the next day. He's like, I got it. I was like, cool. So I chilled for like a week, and it was just like all the other orders, because I put the order in the middle of all the other orders. Nobody saying nothing. I was like, all right, cool. I'm going to send a couple more. I was like, all right, here's my new business. Right, dumbass nigga. 19, yo. Making good bread, right?
Because you're selling new phones at a cheaper price?
Yeah. Because it's just me putting the order in and just sending a phone out. So, you know, it's not costing me nothing. So I start selling these phones on eBay.
That's why I said what he said. Loophole already.
Yo, let me tell you how retarded. Let me tell you how retarded I am. I put, you know, you gotta put an email address for them to hit you up. Wow. Nigga, I put. I'm so retarded. Like, I'm so smart, but I'm retarded. Right? Slow. Right?
You didn't put your email down.
Nigga, I put the Verizon Wireless fucking email. I put the Verizon. Who's this retarded, right? But it was like that impulsive 19, like, just, you know, not. So I wouldn't get charged for the murder one. Like, I get charged for the lower offense, because like they're like, oh, he's just retarded. So I'm selling those phones. Now through that, I get a couple of resellers on the East Coast, actually. And they were buying like 20, 30, 40 phones. So I was making like 10, 15 bands a week, right? I'm having a good time. About 2 months down the line, I get the little, you know, at the desk, and you know, the little white man comes up. But tap me on the shoulder. And you know, there's like, hey, log out. And I'm like, now mind you, I haven't been in trouble ever in my life. You know what I'm saying? This was like my first run in with the law, so I'm not like a professional. Right? So they take me over and they start questioning me and shit. I'm just like, nah, you know what? And like thinking back, I'm like, shut the hell up, nigga. Like, I'm telling them everything. Like, you know what I'm saying? Because they put this big ass fucking folder in front of me with screenshots of like the activity and all that. He was like, we already got you, nigga, so you might as well just, you know what I'm saying, sign right here and, you know, look, man, you have no priors, you know. Man, they ain't going to give me no time, nigga, you know what I'm saying? You're there. I was like, oh, for real? You know what I'm saying? Nah, yeah, you good. So, long story short, so I end up getting 8 months in the clink.
Really?
Yeah, clean 8 months. So I did five in the clink and then three house arrest. And then I have 5 years probation.
Damn.
All right? But here's the thing. I owe restitution, right? So my restitution was like 40, let's just say 50 grand.
What?
Right? So, so I'm like, all right. There's a point to this, by the way. So I get out, my probation officer, and I asked him, I was like, look, so if the 5 years is up, but I still owe the probation, excuse me, the restitution. How does that work? He's like, no, you own probation until that restitution get paid, nigga. And I was like, and I couldn't leave SAC. I would have to stay in SAC until the 50 grand is paid. So what'd that do to my brain? I was like, oh, I got to get a record deal now. Because I can't pay that off making $10 an hour. And I'm a felon. You know what I'm saying? I mean, I never marked the box or anything, but like, you're going to have to earn this information, nigga. So I never, I like this guy. You don't mark the box. Like, that's what it, like, come on. I wasn't that retarded. So I never marked the box. So I started working little odd jobs, but my mind went, you have to do this. That was the only way that I was like, I'm going to get a lump sum of money to pay this off at once. I'm not going to be making no $75 payments to these niggas till I'm 90. You know what I'm saying? Sitting in SAC.
So wait, real quick. When you confessed, right?
Yeah.
You confessed and you also went to the court confessed, I guess, because they locked you up.
Yeah. And then I got my public.
Did you go to trial or you didn't take it to trial? You just copped out.
No, my public defender. I'd already, again, I'm not a career criminal, so I just told him that. And so when I got to my public defender. I never forget the look. She looked at me. She was like, I was like, yeah. I was like, what can we do? She was like, nigga, you already told him. She's like, I ain't got shit to work with, right? She was like, I'll try to, you know, figure it out. And she was like,
Is that considered a white collar crime, basically?
Is it Caucasian collar? Is that what they call it? Is it blue? I never knew the difference.
So let me Google white collar crime.
Yeah. Because I'm in. Because it was white collar crime. No, what's the other blue collar jobs?
That's a job. And
that's
yeah.
what I was. I never knew
the jobs. Yeah, but I never heard about the crime before though.
I heard the term, but I never. I think that is what it is. White collar crime.
Okay, white collar crime definition. White collar crime includes security fraud, embezzlement, corporate fraud, and money laundering. In addition to the FBI entities that investigate white collar crime, include the Security and Exchange Commission, National Association of Securities Dealers. So white collar crime is basically fraud.
It wasn't fraud.
Embezzlement.
It was grand theft.
Grand theft. Okay, hold on.
Yeah, grand theft. And the difference is like the amount of money that it was. Like whatever the amount, like anything.
Was it federal? Were you in the federal? Did you go to the federal? Or you were just...
No. I don't think it wasn't federal.
And yes, grand larceny is a white collar crime. Grand theft.
And so here's the thing. So I was doing it for like two and a half months, but they only caught 2 weeks worth of activity. So if they caught the full 2 months,
oh my God.
I'd probably just now be getting out, like, looking for y'all podcast. Like, who's these niggas? Yo, what? I still got a mic. Like, yeah, like, because they said, like, because it's like a certain limit. It's like, you know, from whatever. So, like, if it would have hit 100,000 or 200,000 or something, that's when it goes to grand larceny and, you know, the charges get increased.
Right, just getting home, man. You know what I mean? Hot rod fresh out. You've been just
fresh out, looking crazy. Looking
so, ripped. you owe them 50,000.
50 stikes.
So you own 50 stacks, and then so what do you start to do now? You just come. Was it hard for you in jail?
Nah. I was cool. They called me. What's that nigga name? McGrady.
Oh, T Mac.
Yeah, they called me McGrady in jail. Like, I don't know. They said I don't know. It was cool. It was cool. Like, you know, cause I didn't go in there acting like I was hard. You know what I'm saying?
You just mind your business.
Yeah, I just came in there the cool nigga. It's like. There's an energy, you know what I'm saying? Like, I just came in there, it was, you know, we was just kicking it. It was cool.
Were you sad?
Yeah, of course. Hella sad. The saddest part is it's like when you get in there and you don't, it's the time aspect of it. Like, the days, like, start going by a little slow. Then you start thinking about what you were doing before. And it's just a mind fuck, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So... yeah, so it was hella sad. And then until I actually settled in, it was like, all right, look, you won't be here for a minute. Like, just relax. You know what I'm saying? So as soon as I relaxed, then it was like, all right, now, oh, shit, Tuesday, casino night. Nigga, we rolling dice with making origami dice. Niggas had casino night, nigga, betting jalapeno chips. So it was like you make it your little shit. Now, I knew that's not where I belong, but I know you got to embrace the situation and be in the moment, and that, you know, once I settled in, I was cool.
How many phones did you end up giving away?
How many phones?
Mm-hmm.
Oh my God, nigga, like, what was that Master P movie?
I got the hookup.
Oh my God.
Like that?
Sheesh. I love that movie, son.
Nigga, that was the greatest movie. I was black selling phones. I was like, look, I was selling phones. I'd be like, all right, cool, 500. So it was the V60s. Right, it was like the little silver joint flip phones. Then it had the S200, I think it was. It was kind of like the first two way type of thing, but it had the
flip
little,
up.
Yeah, it had the keyboard, but it was like a green screen.
Yeah, I know you're talking about.
Yeah, so I was selling them joints, and I would sell them with like 6 months to a year worth of credits on it, so they wouldn't have to pay a bill.
Wow,
that was wilding, super wilding. But again, but I knew they weren't. They weren't monitoring the shit. And I found out later that the only reason why I got caught was my supervisor was like, yo, this motherfucker, he just put new rims on his car. It was like the first Karen. She was like a fat white lady. And she was like, I think he's doing something shady. So it wasn't even like it was just the supervisor going, he's coming up in his Civic. I had like a little shady Civic. And I'm, that's my word, man. And had rims on it and shit. And it was like, yo, Karen just said that he needs to, they need to watch him. So they put the Big Brother system on my computer. You know, the Big Brother thing where they monitor your shit. So me, I'm on my dumb ass, not going to Kinko's or doing my shit on doing it the right way. I'm doing it at work. And that's when they caught that 2 weeks worth of activity. And then that's when the white man came and told me to log out.
Damn, so if you ain't coming in shining with the rims and all, you probably been good for it. You probably been...
Yeah, but it wasn't meant to go that way because they was going to catch me at some point. It was better to be 50,000 rather than 900,000, you know what I'm saying, and me, you know. Mm-hmm.
So what do you do when you get out of jail, owing in this money?
So I get out. So remember before going in, it was me and two of my boys, my high school... My niggas, like my niggas, day ones. So I get out. They had moved to Vegas because we were talking about moving to Vegas, like just trying that out, whatever. So they already moved. So now I'm back in SAC, moved back in, you know, with my mom. And so now I'm on probation. Remember, the last 3 months I did on house arrest. Mm-hmm. So I had to do the house arrest under, you know. So at that point, I think we, oh, I was doing like this, somebody we knew had a janitor business, so he gave me a, so that's how I got out. He wrote this contract, say he's gonna work for me, whatever. So I'm doing that whole thing and making the worst money, and the 3 months was up. I get out, so now I'm officially free. I don't have to be on work release. So then I get a job at ADT, you know, the little home security joints. So worst job. So I'm doing that, whatever. So now I'm like, man, this is, I can't be doing this because I'm going to just live in Sacramento, owing restitution for the rest of my life. I need to, like, figure this shit out, right? Call my boys, yeah, this and that. He's like, look, nigga, just come, you know, come out here and let's figure this shit out, right? I was like, all right, cool. So, you know, I got a probation officer and all that. So it wasn't a drug offense. I didn't have to go pee all every week or nothing like that. So I was like, all right, let me go risk this. I'm going to go out there to Vegas, and I'm going to start recording and just go hard, right? Because my nigga, he was doing real estate and all that. So he had the bread and all that. I was like, all right, cool, let me just do that. So I go to Vegas. So now if I got caught, right, I could have went to, you know, went back to jail or got or violated. But I was like, look, if he calls me, I'll just fly back, you know what I'm saying, and go to the little probation, whatever. This nigga just never called. Like, I was like, all right. Right? So now I'm in Vegas recording mixtapes, trying, you know, selling mixtapes out the damn trunk, you know what I'm saying? Just doing little shit. Now I'm networking and, you know, just doing the whole internet thing now. Cause this is like 2000 and at this point, this is 2001. I want to say 2001-ish. So I'm networking, doing this, you know, making songs, practicing my craft, blah, blah, blah. In the middle of all that, the Arizona real estate boom starts happening. So this is 02, 03-ish. So like, yo, we got to go to Arizona. Right? Because again, my brother's doing real estate, mortgages and all that. Right? I don't know if you remember, if you looked into my past, you saw that I was doing mortgages. You saw that. So that's how all this is coming together. So now we move to Arizona. So I'm a probation fugitive at this point. I'm just moving around, like, you know, I'm supposed to be in Sacramento wilding, but I'm trying to do something with my life. So go to Arizona and same thing. So now my boy was like, look, man, you can do this recording, all that shit. You know, I'm tired of like fronting the bill and all this, like getting to the mortgages thing, right? I was like, all right, cool. You know what? You're right. So I started to get into that. Now at the same time, I'm getting like hella good, like my skills are like getting there, like I'm getting in pocket, and so I'm getting shows out there in Arizona, and you know, just kind of bubbling. Now while in Arizona, there was a website. It was called 602 Streets, right? 602 is the area code for Phoenix. On that, it's like a forum. Kind of like the Coli, like a, you know what I'm saying, but it was a local forum where like all the artists and promoters and whatever, they just all kind of there. So I got, and I was like, okay, this, I can network locally and, you know, the easy way. One day, some nigga, let me not say something, that's very disrespectful. His name is Torres Scott, right? He posts a thread that says, working with G-Unit, looking for demos, or looking for artists, right? So at this point, this is now we're in, I want to say we're now in 2000. At this point, I skipped a couple years, so I think we're in 2004 or 5 right now, right? Now, on this small-ass site, like, you're looking, like, it doesn't make sense, right? You're like, who is this nigga? Like, he's trying to get some money out of some niggas. Like, why would someone look for artists on this little ass Phoenix site? Like, it made no sense, right? But I'm an old why not ass nigga, right? So I hit him. I was like, hey, what's the situation? You know, you looking for money? Like, what? He was like, nah, nigga, just send me a CD. I'm like, oh, okay, why not? So I construct, you know, the CD, whatever, right? Send him the CD. Didn't think nothing else about it, right? Now, again, I'm working in mortgages now, so I'm trying to figure this out, you know, doing the whole mortgage thing. I'm in touch with him. He's like, yeah, you know, you cool. And, you know, hey, man, I'm going to send you some beats and da-da-da. So I was like, oh, he just wanted to find artists to send beats to, right? So I was like, all right, whatever. So I don't think about it no more. January 2006, I'm at work, right? Chilling, you know, talking to these people, you know, people telling me no all day. I get the, remember the sidekicks? The little, I had the little, Dwayne Wade, the little white one. I never forget.
Sidekicks, you should be fired.
Right? Because I'm making a couple of dollars now. I'm feeling myself, you know what I'm saying? And this nigga, like, he hits me on the T-mail. He's like, hey, D Prosper, which was an A&R for G-Unit. He's like, hey, this dude named Derek Prosper wants to call you from G-Unit. And mind you, this is out of nowhere, right? Yeah. I'm like, I was like, all right, cool. So a phone rings, boop. Hello? Hey, what's up, man? You know what I'm saying? He sounded hella like, you know, like a little shady A&R. I'm like, yeah, what's up, man? He's like, yeah. Rod? I'm like, yeah. He said, hey, man, I need to put you on a conference call. I'm like, oh, okay, yeah. I was like, he's like, I'm going to call you right back. I'm like, all right, cool. Boop. You know, 93 seconds go by. He calls back. Hello? Rod? Yeah. Hey, I got 50 on the line.
So you okay?
And 50, he was like, yo, what's up, Rod? What's up? What up? And I'm like, what's up? You know, niggas, like, I'm like, you playing? Like, what? Like, what? Because that was just 0 to 60, you know what I'm saying? I was like, shut the fuck up, right? I was like, shut up. This ain't no 50 Cent. And he started laughing. And you know, his laugh is very distinct, right? I don't know how to do it. And I was like, so that's when my heart went into my asshole. I was like, oh, shit. That's like if you reading off the numbers, like the lotto numbers, and like, you know, you're like, I know what that would feel like, right? So I got up and I walk over to the lobby and I'm like, I'm like, what's up? He was like, yeah, man, you know, what you doing? I'm like, man, you know, I'm over at work. What's up? He was like, yo, I was on a flight, man, from New York to LA, and I popped in your demo. He was like, yo, you got it. Like, nigga, this shit is raw. This shit is hard. And I'm like, oh, you know, just try not to sound weak, you know what I'm saying? But I could barely, like, I'm like, is this really happening? Like, you know, you got those surreal moments, kind of outer body type experience. Like, I'm like, is this really happening right now? And I was like, oh, thanks, man. You know what I'm saying? I probably sound hella corny. And then he was like, yeah. So what's your situation? Like, who you signed to? And I was like, nah, I made that in my bedroom. You know what I'm saying? He's like, what? He said, you ain't got no contracts, like nothing? And I was like, nah. He's like, okay. He's like, where you at? And I was like, I'm at work. He said, quit. I was like, quit? He's like, yeah, we gonna work. We gonna get some work done. I was like, all right. He's like, look, I'm gonna fly you out. Don't bring shit. Just come out here. We're going to figure this shit out. He's like, I can't pass up on this. Like, I need to, like, see what, you know. I was like, all right, cool. You know, he was like, yeah, all right, cool. And then the Prosper nigga was like, I'm going to hit you back. So, boop, hang up. Still, I have this, like, thing. Because, until the plane ticket comes, you know, like even with this situation, I was like, until I see the plane ticket, like, it's not real to me. You know what I'm saying? Or, you know, oh, hey, you got to buy your own plane ticket and send us $1,000. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, so about 9 minutes later, the plane ticket come through to the sidekick. And I was like, nigga, that was the weird, like, that was the craziest shit. I was like, how is this happening right now? Like, and I remember I called my nigga. I was like, hey, nigga, it's happening. He was like, what? I was like, hey, you gonna meet at Buffalo Wild Wings, nigga. meet at Wild Wings up there on McQueen. He was like, what? So I hop in a little LHS and mob over there. Almost died because I'm driving. Like, I probably shouldn't have been driving, nigga. I might as well have been drunk because, like, that was like a weird, You know what I'm saying? Like, I was under the influence of, like, happiness. And, yeah, met up with my boys. We talked about it. We wildin'. And I flew out the next day out here.
Damn.
And I don't know if you want me to hold the steering wheel right now. And I'm like, so I fly out here, right?
What's so funny?
Yo. So I fly out.
That's wild, man.
So I fly out here. And now, mind you, I'm still on probation. I'm still supposed to be in SAC. Nigga. Now I'm in New York. You know what I'm saying? Like, I haven't made any payments on the restitution yet, by the way. So.
Wow. What'd you mean up to this day?
No. I'll tell you. So I fly out here, and the first destination was the G-Unit buildings, right? The first one. So 2006, this was January, so late January. So I go to the G-Unit office, walk in there. And again, it feels like I'm floating. Like, this is like, this is not, like, I feel like Ashton Kutcher going to pop out and be like, ha ha, you dumbass nigga, this isn't really happening.
You went by yourself?
Yeah, I went dolo bolo. So I go in the office, meet everybody, see the little staff, you know what I'm saying? Like, hey, you know, hey, what's up? Oh, Ron. And I'm like, oh my God, this is some real people. And they're like, hey, go in that office. So Shaw Money. So Shaw Money come. I'm like, oh, shit, I know. I used to watch you on TV, you big head ass nigga. Shake up with him. What's up, man? Yeah. He's like, go in the office, you know, 50 be here, you know, whatever. So now I walk in the office, I'm sitting down. And imagine that. Like, this is right after, like, the massacre. You know what I'm saying? Like, this is something. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? And, you know, I'm a huge 50 Cent. Like, we're all 50 Cent fans. Like, but I'm talking about, like.
Facts.
Yeah, like, this isn't.
I get it.
You know what I mean? It's just to paint the picture. So now I'm sitting in the office. And, you know, when you're on the outside, you don't know how niggas are. You don't know. You only know what you see, you know what I'm saying, on TV. Like, you're not on the inner. So, you know, so your brain's trying to put it together, right? So I think this nigga's going to walk in with two Rottweilers, you know what I'm saying? Like, or with two fucking AR-15s, you know what I'm saying? Not really, but you know what I mean? Like, I thought he was, I just didn't have any concept of how this was going to go. Because I never thought of myself as a on G-Unit, like this, because I wasn't going, I'm going to kill you, nigga, I'm going to sell drugs. I didn't rap like that. Like, you know what I'm saying? I was fun. I was like, you know what I'm saying? Like, it was club records or talking about having sex with your girlfriend or, you know, just that shit. Braggadocious type bars. So the label that I always saw myself probably being with was like Ludacris. It was like a DTP, like more like, oh, you could be more fun. So anyway, so the whole shit is just weird. 50 walks in and my heart goes right back to my asshole again. And I'm like, oh, shit. And I stand up, shake up with him. Yo, what's up? What's up?
Stand up.
I'm like, yo, this shit is crazy. And he walks and he sits behind his desk. So kind of like how this setup is, he sits behind his desk. I'm sitting in the chair. And he was like, yo, what's up? Like, what's going on, man? I'm like, you know, whatever, just small talk. Now, this is what kind of set the tone and what it showed what kind of nigga that 50 was, right? So the intern walks in. It was like some little white girl. She walks into the office with a Caesar salad. Hey, here, 50. Here's the Caesar salad. You know what I'm saying? He was like, oh, thank you. He opens it up. She's like walking out. He was like, oh, hey, Sarah, I said no croutons, right? And she starts pissing on herself. No, oh my God, like, you know. He was like, oh, no, it's cool. Like, I'll pick him off. It's all good. I just want to let you know, like, just for next time. Just remember that, all right? And she was like, oh, and she left. So at that, I saw he was a real, like, he wasn't going to flex on her. And I was like, oh, he's a real nigga. Like, because he could have easily flexed, you know what I mean? So I was like, okay. So I kind of took it down because I was, like, super nervous, you know what I'm saying? But just to see how he interacted with his intern, that was, like, super dope to me. So we just start talking about shit, like, just like, yeah, what's up? And we just start shooting the shit. And probably, like, 6 minutes in, I'm just feeling like I'm talking to another nigga. Like, that's just how cool it was. You know what I'm saying? So we just started talking about what's going to happen. He was like, all right, look, so, you know, we're going to go to the house, to the mansion. We're going to record. You know what I'm saying? We're going to do all this shit. You know, we're going to figure this shit out. Go, you know, you got to get a lawyer. And it just started going hella fast. I'm like, and mind you, I'm 20, what year is this? Six. I'm 25, fresh out the clink. You know what I'm saying? And like, you know, I wasn't prepared for this shit, but it was like, it was just great. It was a great experience to like, it grew me up but I wasn't prepared for any of this shit. You know what I'm saying? But it just started moving a million, you know, miles per minute. And I was living at the mansion, you know.
Connecticut?
Yeah. I was living there because it was just like, all right, nigga, your whole job is to wake the fuck up and record and, you know, and move around and figure this shit out, you know. And I think he was kind of like, I think at one point he probably was like sitting there like, I was really told this nigga to quit his job and come out here. he did say that later because he didn't know what I looked like, right? I could have been an old weird, you know what I'm saying? He just heard the music. Like, there was no artwork. It was on a shady-ass CD with a Sharpie. with my phone number on it, like in a clear case, like he said that, like he was like if you walked in there looking hella stupid, like I probably would have been like, you know what I'm saying? Damn. So it was a huge risk. So that was kind of a funny story, but yeah. So I'm living at the mansion now. Oh my god, there's so many stories. there's so much shit. My brain's like doing this right now. Like, I don't even, like, chronological order is getting weird now.
All right, so let's
yeah, this is just kind of
let's
hard,
give you a like, break. Let's give you a little intermission because he told a whole like hour story just now. All right, so
but it's so interesting. It's like the most interesting story
ever. Now, of course, sorry. So you flew into New York, you met 50 at the office.
Yeah,
you go to the crib. Straight to work now. Now you're recording every day.
Yeah,
who was living in the mansion with you?
So, Hove. Do you know these niggas?
I know Hove. Trav brother.
Yeah, Trav was, yeah. So Hove was the
role manager.
Yeah, he was a nigga taking care of the house and all that shit.
Yeah, shout out to Hove.
Mm-hmm. You know Kai Miller?
I know Kai.
Kai, he's the engineer.
Not that Kai. Sorry,
guy. Oh, okay. But he was another nigga. He was there. He was going back and forth, but he was living there. But he was like the in-house engineer. And I think that was it. Yeah, it was just, yeah. In this big-ass fucking hotel, that was the most frustrating house to fucking live in. Like, you was getting your cardio in, nigga. Like, it was just to go over here. Like, it was ridiculous. But it was a great workout.
So 50 didn't live there, though?
Yeah. That was his
main home base. Hub. Okay.
Yeah. So that was home base. Like, that was home base. So trying to sprinkle these stories in too. So this is fucking weird. It was like a movie, man. So the first night, we get there. So now she's like, he sold me the studio. So we, you know, he drive back and forth. So now we're driving back. I remember it was hella cold. And I remember pulling up to the mansion from driving from the city to Connecticut. Seeing the snow, and I remember looking out the window. I'm like, what? Like, then the whole outer body thing happened again. I'm like, wow, I'm really pulling up to this nigga's house. Like, what's happening? And we go in the house, gives a tour, does all this shit. It was like, yeah, here's the gym, here's the club. I remember it was Mike Tyson's old house. It was like that crazy. And he was like, all right, so here's your room. All right, you know, we got to get up early. We're going to get it cracking, right? So went to sleep. Next morning, man, there's no blinds on the damn on the shit, so like the sun's like staring at me, hella bright. I'm like, come on, man. It's like 7 a.m. Look over, and this girl walks into my room, right? She had like a G-string on, and you know, bro. And I'm like, what's happening right now? Right? What's going on? So, man, I'm in the bed, and I'm looking, I'm like, And she sits on the bed. And now she wasn't even that good at her job because she didn't make me comfortable. Like, she seemed nervous, right? So in turn, I'm nervous, right? And I'm like, okay, what am I supposed to do here? Like, so now my brain is going, am I getting tested? Like, is that his baby mom's? Like, what's happened? You know, I didn't say that, but.
I know, I understand.
She says next, she's like, hey, what's up? And she starts doing a little joint with her finger on my knee. And I'm like, what's that? Like, am I supposed to blow your back out right now? Or am I supposed to not? Like, you know what I'm saying? Like,
I would feel the same way.
No, it's weird, right?
I would feel the same way.
What do you do? Right? What am I doing here?
I don't ask me no questions.
Because no.
I don't answer them. I would feel the same way, bro. I see it.
I'm from Queens, so I get a Queens nigga move. Shout out to the OG. Yeah, you don't know what to get.
Because I'm a nasty nigga. Like, but this ain't no regular situation. You know what I'm saying? If I'm not my home or something. It's like, okay, this nigga send her. She was like, hey, so, you know, what's going on, this and that. She started talking. I'm like, yeah. She's like, so, you know, you want to get down? Or however she said it. Mm. I'm like, yeah, you know what I'm saying? She's like, all right. And she like, gets on her knees. And I'm like, all right. So I pull my joint out. Right? But I'm so nervous.
G, don't press the button. G, stop. Let it.
I'm so nervous that my joint don't even get right. Pointless.
G! It happens to the best of us, man. G.
Yo, my joint did not show up. Stage was too big, man. And that was just she kind of looked at me like, you know, she was like, wow. She didn't say nothing, but, you know, you could see in her eyes, like, wow, you're hella whack. But I was like, you know, this is just uncomfortable. I don't know what the fuck's going on right now. You know what I'm saying?
That's a real story, man.
And whatever, she, you know, puts her titties back, and then she goes back downstairs.
Chill, G. I know you like this guy. Chill. Okay.
Yo, but it was.
No, G.
I'm just trying to paint the picture of how much of a movie this was. Like, it didn't feel real. There's, like, a lot of shit was happening, like. But that was, like, my first, like, weird, like, my first encounter, like, there, to where it was, like, I still don't know to this day was that a test or, like, I never even spoke about it. I don't know. I didn't know. Mm. You know, but from there, so they had an intercom. It's like, right, go come to the studio. Come to the studio. I think Hove was on there. He's like, come to the studio. Hove. Got some Hove stories. Anyways, go to the studio. And then we just started working on the album, you know, going through beats. And so it just became that. It became wake up hella early. Record, you know, work out, eat, you know what I'm saying? Come to the city, meetings, you know. That just became my life for, like, you know, maybe a couple months.
How long you lived at the house for?
I want to say it was probably like 6 to 8 months, maybe. Something like that. Mm-hmm. But there's a story why that ended.
Before you go there, did you sign anything before you went to the house, or you just, that was just like?
No.
Okay.
So didn't sign anything, and it was all being worked out while I was there. You know what I'm saying? So remember, this was, I came out late January 2006. So, you know, into February, recording, you know, meetings, doing all that shit, and, I ended up getting my lawyer, and that's when I started having the meetings, and then the paperwork started coming in, and, you know, all that, all of it didn't get finalized until, like, May, like, late May. But at that point, I was already recording and traveling and doing all that shit. But there's a crazy story about that, too. There was so much shit that happened. Yo, them niggas hated me.
Who?
all them niggas, them G-Unit niggas, all the little goons and the Hove. And now, mind you, this is coming off the game situation.
Why would Hove hate you for?
Some new nigga. Where did I come from? Right? From the West Coast. Now, because 50 was like, yo, this is that nigga. Like, he was, it was kind of like that. Who? Why is he getting all this attention? And you know what I'm saying? Like, I came out of nowhere, and that energy was weird.
I just think that's how New York niggas are. I don't think.
Nah, them niggas was, yeah.
Did you meet Mazaradi Fox?
Yeah. this is the stories that's coming in my head.
Rest in peace
to
Fox, man.
Yo, rest in peace, Fox.
because Fox had the, because, you know, when you hear stories about 50, you know what I mean? Shout out to 50, man. He was a generous guy, man. I remember, you know, Bino telling me and Fox telling me that 50 just seen Fox and gave him a lot of money. Like,
yeah.
50 put niggas in positions. Mm-hmm. So this is why, you know what I mean? I can see, but, you know, like Hov and them, shout out to them. I mean, they had their position already. They were solidified. So why would they be, what were you doing? Were you annoying? Like, you know, I can't just see niggas being mad at you for no reason.
Nah, it was just, the, you know, it was the energy. You know what I'm saying? It was like,
or were you expecting love? Like, because 50 gave you love, so you were expecting it from everyone? Was that like a...
Yes.
It don't work like that, man. From Queens, nigga. That shit don't work.
I see. I see that. But no, but I understood it because it was like it was a territorial energy. You know what I'm saying? Like, but again, remember the whole game? This was during the G-Unit type era.
I remember.
So I think that was like they had a... you know, this is what it was. Because remember, he signed Spider after that whole game, Spider Lope.
I remember.
Shouts to Spider. Now, Spider fit the G-Unit. You know what I'm saying? He's the crip nigga. You know what I'm saying? He hard, you know, all that shit. Like, yeah, all right. Me, I come in here, you know what I'm saying? The cool, you know, fun nigga, whatever, you know. I wasn't coming in on none of that. So it was a different energy. So where I felt like nigga was like looking at me like, who is this, like, who is this nigga? Like, why is 50 so on this nigga? Like, G-Unit's not a, like, G-Unit is fucking guerrilla unit. Like, it's supposed to be that. So it was kind of a mix of that. Like, he ain't no street nigga. So I felt like they thought I was like a corny, square nigga.
Yeah, okay.
Right? So I felt that, which there was times where that had to get checked. You know what I'm saying? Not that nigga said nothing, but it was like, you know, like with somebody talking to you, I forget who that nigga was. It wasn't Trav, but it was like another nigga. And he was like just talking to me. And I remember looking at this nigga. I was just like, so it was like a big party at the mansion. And I remember looking at the nigga and I'm like, why are you talking to me like this? Mm-hmm. Right? And it was like, it was kind of like, kind of, he kind of woke up like, oh, you know, like when you think you could talk to somebody and I'm like, no, you look at nigga, I'm like, why are you talking to me like this? Like, what did I do to make you comfortable to talk to me like this? And it was kind of like one of those, you know, that was like the only time I had to really get checked. But that's when I kind of...
You did the Trav, you said?
No, it wasn't Trav. It was like...
Okay, yeah, okay.
No, it wasn't Trav. Nah, shouts to Trav. It was like, but it was like, it was somebody, because at that time, Trav wasn't the rapper. Like, Trav was just like one of the niggas. Like,
yeah, Trav was around, yeah, Trav family.
He's a writer, you know what I mean?
Yeah, he really went hard for the G-Unit stuff. Trav. As a kid, he had every pair of G-Unit sneakers. Like, Trav... really represented where we was at. Yeah, shout out.
Trav was one of them niggas. Like, it was funny because I came in. So at that point, we had went to the jeweler and I already had my shit. I was like shining. And I remember Trav like came up and he was like, damn nigga, I need to start rapping. So it's funny like to see, you know, because you know, he started doing this thing later, but that was like a cool moment because he was like, I need to start rapping. Y'all niggas, you getting money like that, nigga? Like, blah, blah. So it was kind of, you know, to see him move around and whatnot, but but that was the kind of energy it was. It was kind of like, it was a territorial, you know, who is this nigga, you know, type of energy that it was on, you know, and there's this, yeah, definitely with the whole situation, we had our little, you know, weird moments of, because remember, it was just him living in the house, now it's me living in the house, you know what I'm saying, and now it was kind of like, you know, just weird. It was just weird. You know what I'm saying? There was like little situations that were happening where, so this is going to lead up to why the house thing happened. Because, you know, I said I lived there for 6 to 8 months.
Yeah. What about Fox, though? You said something about Mazaradi Fox.
So Fox is in there, too. All right, so about, I would say maybe like 2 months
call me in. F.O. Where the lay down flow.
Dumb out.
Fried to your dome. Inside of your dome. Ain't behind bars. Mazaradi. Dumb out. I used to live with that nigga.
Wait, you lived with Mazaradi Fox?
I lived with Fox for about 5 months.
Shut the... How are you still alive?
What? Why? I'm from Queens. Nigga, what you talking about? I'm still alive. Me and Fox had a fight and everything.
Wait. You lived... Wait, y'all was roommates?
I lived with Fox in NC and his, at Loretta and them house. I lived in his family house in North Carolina. Yeah.
Wait, Jackson after did. He got out? Or before?
Yeah. No, what you mean? Like before when he got out of jail?
Yeah.
The first time.
I'm saying like in 06, 07? Was it 06?
He got out of jail.
What it was 06. When he got out of prison and 50 gave him some bread and set him up and all
yeah,
that.
Yeah, I was living with him.
That's you was living with Fox?
I was living with Fox in North Carolina for a while, yeah.
Wow. Yeah. How was that? Was that wild? Geez,
I don't want to talk about that. It was good. I mean, shout out to his family. Shout out to his whole family, Raj and all those people over there, man. They showed me a lot of love, man. They were welcoming. But I remember going out there, I had no money or nothing. He looked out for me at one point.
Yeah.
Let me drive his Tahoe and you know, he still was in the streets, but you know, there you go.
Yeah.
Rest in peace.
That nigga was crazy. Rest in peace, Fox. I got some good stories with him too.
He's a dumb out for real.
Dumb out. Dumb out. Yo, he was a trend. No, he came out trend setting. Like, that's one thing I realized too. Like, when you a shooter or you a real nigga, like, you kind of fast track your progress because niggas are scared of you. And so whatever you do, like, niggas is telling you yes all day because they're scared of you. And I remember just seeing that, the way he moved, like, got the studio hella quick, got this, was getting cars.
I think it was a respect thing.
Yeah, because he's a shooter.
But no, I think
there's
a lot of shooters around, believe it or not.
There's a lot of fake niggas, but shooting, that's rare. People that act like, what's more common, shooters or the fake niggas, or the non-shooters that act like they shooters?
Just in general you talking about?
What do you mean?
In general, because you asked me as far as that click, I want to know that click, but I knew.
No, just like just in general.
I mean, of course, non-shooters, right? But it's also when you're from Queens, as Queens niggas, we respect. You know, it's not a fear thing; it's more of a respect thing. When somebody, you know, puts in work, you have an understanding. But a lot of people over there put in a lot of work. Believe it or not,
yeah.
They didn't look like they may have not looked like it because the job happened so quick for them.
Right. Right.
The job, like 50 took niggas out the hood and put them in position, so they had to adjust.
Super quick.
They had to adjust to that lifestyle, you know what I'm saying? But, you know, when you from the hood and you understand, I mean, some niggas probably didn't like F.O. the way, F.O. fucked up situations as well. He did fucked up, you know, I remember when F.O. fucked up the G-Unit situation. I was around for that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah. You know, with the whole Mob Deep manager and all this type of crazy shit and... G-Unit South shit. I don't want to get into it. I get into it another time. But I'm just saying, I remember that.
Yeah.
I remember, being overzealous, man. And shout out to F.O. We talked about it at one point. We laughed about it and shit like that. And But, you know, the thing is, it was a respect thing.
That's true, yeah.
You know what I mean?
That's what I'm saying that. Yeah, like, you do. You respect the shooter.
I got you. Okay, got it.
Meaning that. So not just reducing him down to that, but I agree with you is what I'm saying. Like, he was. Like, you do have that respect because it take a certain type of nigga to move like that. You know, but yeah, I gotta tell you this Fox story. So I'm shooting a video with, so there's a song called Bump My Shit. And, I'm shooting this video with Scenario. You know Scenario?
Yep. Yeah, of course.
Yeah. So shouts to Scenario.
Rio. Shouts to my boy.
Yeah. So we shooting it with Scenario. And, so we're doing the scenes or whatever. So, you know, I'm not from here, you know, I'm not hip to the whole situation, you know, the areas and all that. So we go to this one spot where it's like a studio, right? Not a music studio, but like a photography or video, you know, like a studio that has like good backdrops and shit like that. So we go to the studio and whatever, we start shooting. So we got the cars out and all that, right? I get a call on my phone, right? Boop! I'm like, oh, hold on. Hello, it's Fox, right? I'm like, what's up, nigga? He was like, nigga, where you at? What you doing, nigga? You know, he always on 100, right? I'm like, nah. I'm like, yo, I'm shooting this video, nigga. Like, what? Wait, what? I'm shooting this video, man. I got hurt. Nah, nigga, you tripping, nigga. You tripping. Hey, nigga, you in Jimmy Henchman's hood. Now, this was around that time that whole shit went down, mm-hmm. right? With his son and all that. Niggas, sorry, talking, boop, boop. Hey, I'm about to pull up, nigga.
I remember that situation.
You remember that?
I remember that. Yeah. He came up there.
He came up there deep.
Yeah. I think was Trav there?
I don't know. There was a few cars.
Yeah, he came up there. I remember.
It was like.
Bino was there, my man. Was Bino home? I don't know, but I remember that situation.
It was in Brooklyn. Brooklyn. It was in Brooklyn.
I remember that, yeah.
And I remember this nigga pulled up like it was a caravan. I forget how many cars it was. In my mind, there was 1,000 cars. But, you know, how many ever cars it was. I remember he pulled up and was like, hey, nigga, get in the car, nigga. So I'm like, man, what? I'm getting in the car. He's like, yeah, nigga, you tripping. Like, the niggas could have came up here and sprayed up the whole scene. They heard a new G-Unit, nigga. And I was like, damn, this old thorough-ass nigga. Like, so, I was like, this is a real-ass nigga. You know what I'm saying? You know, yeah, he crazy. But like you saying, like he is. He's like, he knew how to move. And he had that, you know, that whole shit down. He was like, man, fuck that shit. You know, I should slap that nigga scenario. That nigga, he should have known. And, you know, because I'm just going off a scenario situation. And he was like, scenario should have known that situation.
Scenario was more focused on getting a job done. Okay.
Right, right. But, you know, but he's, you know, but Fox is just kind of looking at us like, we a team, you know, like, you know, he was just on go. And he was like, we'll shoot, nigga, we'll shoot that shit, nigga. Like, we'll go to the studio and we'll. So. If you see that video, because that, you know, Fox, Trav, you know, all the goons, all that shit, we ended up shooting that video that day off, you know, we was just winging it, you know what I'm saying? Because after that, we scrapped all the scenario scenes, and we just went to Fox's studio, went over to another thing, you know what I'm saying? So it was just kind of cool. The video came out super tight.
Yeah, I'm looking at it now.
You know what I'm saying? So you'll see Fox in there. You'll see Trav, you'll see Banks' brother and all that. Like, that's how that all happened. It was like, it was just a good moment. Like, it was a good situation.
You appreciated that.
I really did, yeah. That was like, wow, like, that's a real nigga. But that was like some more movie shit. Like, it was just a bunch of movie shit happening the whole time. Like, but yeah, that was one of my Fox stories that, you know, that was very memorable. But yeah, Fox came to the house. He was living there when he got out. And at that point, one of my niggas, so an artist that I was working with, I had him come out because, you know, he was going to be like my hype man and all that. So he was living there too, right? And he ended up being like a slimy nigga, whatever. But, you know, that come with the territory. But there's a situation, which I still don't know to this day what happened. Fox ended up telling somebody that my nigga was getting drugs shipped to the house. Right? And I'm like, what? Right? Like, how? No one's that stupid, right? So I'm thinking, like, so I'm asking this nigga, like, what? And he was like, nah, I got some clothes shipping over here and da da da. I'm like, nigga, you ain't that stupid to be sending no drugs. So, nah, nah. And he showed me there was like a box of clothes and shit like that. And I'm like, so that ended up blowing up into this whole situation where 50 kicked everybody out. So he, because he was like, I don't know what the fuck's going on. Like, nobody's telling me no story. All I'm hearing is Fox coming to me saying drugs. And it came, like, it came out that maybe Fox was hating or I don't know what happened. But that was something that ended up souring the whole, you know, like, situation. You know what I'm saying? That's what.
So 50... had a meeting with everybody, which he does, right? Was it everybody? Or was
nah, it wasn't a, I don't think, we didn't have a meeting. It was just like, everybody got to get the fuck out type of thing. Like, yeah.
So he didn't find no drugs in the premises.
Nah, there was nothing there, but it was kind of, it was like, why am I even, what's happening right now? Like, why am I even having to even think about this? Like, even if this was just made up, which I think it was made up, or maybe it was some, I don't know. I really have no idea. Fox said whatever he said, and my boy said this. I really don't think he would do that. That's just stupid. But like Fox started that, told somebody, and then I got around, and I think 50 was just like, I don't even want to think about this. Get the fuck out of my house. But it wasn't like, fuck you, but it was like, okay, time to go.
You got to find your own place.
Yeah, like, we still working, you know what I mean? Like, but you got to go back to Arizona.
And that was the thing you said earlier about the whole 6 to 8 months when you left the house, that was the situation you talking about?
Yeah. Where we had to...
So what happened with you and Hove, though? Like you said you and Hove, like, what situation, what was the worst situation that happened with y'all?
So the whole situation, so that was another situation. So 50 would always, you know, 50 would leave for extended periods of time, you know, whether he had to go overseas or he had to go do whatever, right? So sometimes he wouldn't be there for like a week, 2 weeks at a time, you know what I'm saying? And obviously me coming there, I'm going to follow the lead of, the nigga that was already living there, you know what I'm saying? So one night, Hove was like, yo, we need to have some, we need to get some holes over here. So me, I'm not thinking about that. Like, I don't know if I can invite girls over. Like, it didn't even seem like that. Like, that didn't even make sense to me, right? He's like, nah, we're going to find some holes and da-da-da. So we buy some holes over. You know, I'm like, oh, okay, it's cool. We invite holes over. Some holes come over. You know, we drinking, kicking it, whatever. And, you know, in that house, you're going to have sex with the girl, you know, because as soon as they walk in there, you know, it's just whatever. So we blow their backs out.
That sounds crazy. Yeah.
Next morning. This nigga bugged back. Next morning. So the girls, they have to sign in. Right? To the house. Because there's a guard security gate or box, whatever you call it. So they have to sign in. The next morning, one of the girls never signed out, which started this whole thing. Like, where's this bitch at? Where's this girl at? Excuse me.
Like, okay, get to the story. Yeah, so you see, then get to the story. Suspenseful ass nigga. Come on.
No, I'm trying to. I take pride in my stories.
You know? Respect. All right, take it.
Yeah. I don't be like, oh yeah, then this bitch didn't sign out, and then haha, that was it. So, she didn't sign out. That became a thing, right? Now, the girl, I think she left. Like, she just didn't. She got too drunk and she like just left. But she like left through the woods or some shit, right? That we found out later, right? But it got back. It was a red flag because it was like, hey, three girls came in, two came out, right? This nigga blamed that on me. He was like, oh, that nigga Rod did that shit. And I remember looking, this nigga looked me right in my face. And I remember going, and you know, like when some shit happens, like, you know, like if somebody look, and you're like looking, and you're going, it's like weird. You're like slimy, you know what I'm saying? You know, like the slimy niggas, like, and like blame, he was like, yeah, like you gotta, you know, that's on, like, he did that shit. So that was like one of the first times I had to dip, but I was allowed back. But I had to go, because he blamed it on me. And I remember going, I'm like, nigga, are you serious? He was like, you know, you just gotta charge to the game, my nigga. And it's like, I'm like, you slimy nigga.
When did you go back to Arizona?
I went back to Arizona. Now this leads into, so at this point, at this time, the paperwork's not done, right? So there's like this, like, oh fuck, like, I ain't even signed no paperwork yet. Like, what's happening, right? At this point, I've already seen the contract. Oh, no, I haven't seen the contract. I've seen versions of it, but it was still getting edited. And we're leading up to an Interscope, what do you call that? A showcase. You know, they have those showcases with the new artists. Mm-hmm. So this is when Pharrell had some new artists, and the Busta name was there, Busta, and had signed somebody. Like, it was just some new artists and all that shit, right? So they were like, look, so I was rehearsing at the house and all that, right? But then all that shit went down. He was like, you go home, We gonna see you in L.A. No, it was in Orlando. And you better be ready for this performance. Right? I'm like, all right, cool. Rehearsing, whatever. End up flying out there. Get there. So now I'm at the hotel where they're holding it. It's like one of those big, you know, slutty, you know, five-star joints. And everybody's there. Interscope, you know, everybody. It's like a star-studded event. So I'm there. So I got my boy with me, Carnegie, rest in peace. He's gonna be my hype man. And my lawyer, no. 50's lawyer was there. And I see this nigga in the lobby. And he walks up. He was like, hey, what's up, Rod? Da, da. So he walks up with this fucking paperwork. And he walks up to me. He's like, yeah. Some of y'all heard what's going on, da, da, da. He was like, yeah, 50 gave me the instruction. Hey, here's the contract. If you fuck up, I'm going to have to rip this up. I'm like, come on, man. You really got to tell me that, like, right before the performance. So I'm like, this is in May. So I'm going, end of January. Already recorded the album, February, March, April. So I'm already feeling like I'm already, you know what I'm saying? We've done show, you know. Now we're doing this showcase, and this nigga comes up to me with the fucking contract and goes, hey, here's the contract, like dangling it. Like, I was like, come on, man. I was like, yeah, I got it, you know what I'm saying? Immediately go to the bar, because I got to get twisted now, because my brain, because now I'm like, I don't want to fuck this up. So now the fear is taking over. You know what I'm saying? Like, if you fuck this up, da-da. So I just start getting tossed with my nigga, right? Rap. The showcase starts. I'm headlining, right? First couple people go, the acts, like, I think it was the Pharrell's acts and all that, da-da-da. Guess who's on before me? Busta Rhymes and Split Star. They had some artists, whatever. And then these niggas just gonna take the show over and perform for an hour. You know how they perform. They throwing the fucking mic back and forth and doing somersaults and, you know, just wilding. You know how crazy their performance is. Mm-hmm. And I'm sitting there going, really? Like, really? You just gonna come on before me like that? You know what I'm saying? Because me, I ain't shit yet. You know what I'm saying? Man, I got hella sad. I remember I told the one of the niggas to bring me the Grey Goose bottle. So I'm getting tossed now, right? Finally, they fucking get off the stage. I'm hella mad. I'm like, these niggas did that on purpose. That's just rude. And show start. Oh, 50 comes by. He was like, all right, you ready? And I think he saw that. So he was like, so he ran up there with me and Hype Man with me for the show, right? Killed the show, right? I damn near blacked out. I don't know how. I was just on autopilot, you know what I'm saying? Because I didn't want to think about it. I was so fucking drunk. But killed the show. Killed it. Did like four records. Did the Be Easy record, Chase the Cat, you know, Rock to It, and another one. Killed it. And I remember after that, I remember like Pharrell ran up and like Jimmy Iovine ran up. Oh, shit, it was crazy. Busta ran. Like, it was another movie feeling, like, oh shit, this nigga's gonna be the next nigga. Like, I'm really thinking I'm gonna be the next nigga at this point. Like, it was like really that. Lawyer came up, oh yeah, nigga, you know, da da da. And that was like another surreal moment. Cause remember going into that's coming fresh off of the shit. Like, he hates me. So that was another like moment that I had, the Interscope showcase. Like, that shit was crazy. That was like a whole thing. So. Yeah. So yeah, Hov was hating.
I don't know if he was hating, but
no, he literally lied and said I did that and I didn't. So that's hating.
I think that you were new and you had to take one for the team.
Come on, Queens.
Why I gotta be hating instead of just taking one for the team?
But what do you hate in the story? Just now,
and why would Hov hate on you? Hov already position was already solidified.
I felt he didn't want me to be there anyway.
Probably.
Why would you jeopardize the new artist? So if your boss brings in a new recruit that he's fully co-signing, that he's fully, He's investing money into this man, mm-hmm. right?
I'm listening.
And like literally making like this is the next nigga. This is the next album coming out. This nigga, we're in the studio. We're gonna go. This is the nigga. You get in a situation, right? It ends up a jam. So now you're in a jam. You're gonna put that nigga's neck on the line.
Yeah, why not? Because
Hov, that's slimy.
No, wait, hold on. Hov is there longer. His
that's slimy.
Let me finish. I just heard you clearly. Hov is there longer. Hov has a bigger responsibility. Who gets the? You should know better, Hov or Hot Rod. That's how you gotta look at it. Like, not like he hated on you. He probably didn't like you because your personality. You do got a personality probably that don't fit with. Because where they from? From Southside Queens. Them niggas is around.
50 that's
niggas.
Hating.
It's not hating.
Or survival. We're in the survival mode.
It's no survival mode because you didn't do. Certain personalities don't match, right? It could be, but everybody go through hazing when they're new. Freshmen, everybody. That's a part of life. Everybody go through that.
That wasn't no haze.
No, hold on. Everybody don't make it right, though. That. I didn't say it made it right. That's not what I'm saying.
Because if it was a haze, I get that. That wasn't no haze.
We can't say hating, though. Hov would get... Hov's job is to be... Hov had a big job.
Right, he did.
50 kick niggas off of shit. Shit happened with Smurf. We talked to Smurf about it. Fight?
Yeah.
That's how 50 is. If nobody can have an answer or something, Hov know that. Why not blame the new? You take the blame. Cause 50 gonna look down on him, like nigga, you should know better. How you gonna you lived here longer before him, and you let a bitch escape in the woods? So who's likely to like? Damn, I should have known better. The new nigga, think about what I'm saying. Don't call it. You feel hate? You was there. I'm just saying my opinion from outside looking.
Yeah.
I can see why I would Hov hate on you because. I don't understand his
It was territorial. I'm telling you.
But territorial and hate is two different things. His position wasn't in question. His position, well, he wouldn't have been moved from his position unless himself.
But he did so much fuck shit, he ended up getting removed.
That's between him and 50. I wasn't aware of that. Were you there when he got removed? I don't think you was there.
No, that was later.
Yeah.
But no. But there was a string of events that were happening.
Of course.
You know? So I don't know, I felt, whatever, that's how I took it.
I respect
I think
your,
both points make sense, though.
I respect your opinion. I don't want you to feel like that. When you say hate, I'm trying to see, like, okay, whole position been solidified for a long time.
He was down.
I'm trying to figure, how would he get, you know, he probably just didn't like you.
That means hate. You're going to hate.
Okay.
If you don't, to do something and... He would have been so happy if I was just gone. That's hate. Like, if a nigga is here and I'm like, oh, this nigga. Like, if there's some nigga that's fucking a bitch that you want to fuck, you don't like him, and you're going to do something to get him removed from her life so you can try to get into her life, that's hate.
That's hate. That's different. But let me tell you something.
I feel like they felt what about I was taking.
Let's use an example. You got your little cousin that you have babysitting your Airbnb, your house.
Yes.
You meet a girl. You say, you know what? Put your son there. Now, your little cousin been babysitting your house for about 3 years.
3 years, yeah.
You bring the guy is there for 5 months. Something important that you had there gets stolen from the house.
Right.
Who are you going to hold accountable? Your little cousin's going to blame the new nigga because he, in his mind, like, he don't really know the rules.
But that's whack.
No.
Wait, are you saying it's just not... You're agreeing that's whack, right? Or are you...
What do you
are
mean? It's not right to blame somebody, but I understand the blame.
Got you. I was just trying to see where
No. Listen. It's not right to blame somebody, but I understand. I don't look at it as... My opinion...
Yeah.
And I respect your opinion, is I can't see Hov hating because of his position. I can't see... He was already solidified. My opinion. That's how I looked at it.
I feel like he was doing that because he was in jeopardy. If he was solidified, why not be like, all right?
He could have found a better handle of the situation.
Yeah, if you solidified, you
don't.
Like,
you trying to tell me you don't think Hov was solidified at that time he was there? Really?
No. I think he was but he still feared. I think he was solidified, but I think he feared.
He wasn't trying to rap, nigga. Come on, man.
No, This is 50. Everyone know this. Like, 50 was... Everyone was like, we don't fuck up or 50 gonna send you home.
We all know that because he's been sending niggas home since Get Rich or Die Trying. When you fucked up on the record. We'll get into that. He's been sending niggas home since Get Rich or Die Trying. He was sending niggas, we know that.
That was the
he
whole thing.
When niggas had a fight, when niggas had a fight by the bus stop, Smurf and Joffy and them.
Right.
Everybody, that's how 50 is because he's not jeopardy. I learned a lot. Like, people think that, I got the utmost respect for 50. I have to say this.
Yeah.
And I learned a lot from him watching his career and understanding. I saw him one time in person when I was younger. Yeah. G-Money saw him one time sitting on the crate at God Bro. You know what I'm saying? But one thing about it is that how I take it is that he's not going to let anyone jeopardize his position.
Right, right, right.
You're not going to make him look bad. We came from the mud up, and he's not going to lose that position, and I respect that.
Right.
With that being said now,
okay,
a lot of people, because of his action, niggas know how 50 is. Like, oh, you doing this? He just sent a group of niggas home that he brought from Southside.
Right.
Everybody went back to the hood.
Yeah.
Fox fucked up. I seen it. I was there personally, like, damn, Fox, what the fuck you did?
Yeah,
there?
Why you
some
here?
Shit with some money and some niggas from the call came up to the G Unit off. I don't know the whole story.
Yeah.
That's how 50 is. So, but when you say Hov, right?
Right.
Listen to me.
I'm listening.
Hov is a road man, and I'm trying to figure out, probably Hov, your flip, you think Hov liked me? No, I don't think Hov liked you if you're saying that, right?
Right.
But to say Hov was hating, I don't understand. Like, it's two different category of niggas. Fox was doing music. I can see. I'm going to say Fox was a hater because Fox is not a hater. But I can see Fox is known for doing crazy shit. F.O. From me knowing him personally. F.O. is an overzealous person. And when he's there, he tries to take over a lot of things.
Right, right.
That's how Fox is. But right. Hov, I can't see. I can't. Maybe I have somebody else to blame so I could do things that I wouldn't normally do. Maybe. But you think it's hate or just putting you out there that you, because you, did you expect to be accepted with love? Like, what was your expectations looking at it? Like, you expected him to, because y'all only was the ones living there? Like, I want to know your vision.
I think the energy I felt was, like I said earlier, it was like, I'm coming through. Who's this nigga? There's still a sour taste in everyone's mouth from the game situation.
It's true.
Right? You remember how that went down? It was
that
like,
did. It went down bad. Yeah.
They didn't have a very, you know, the game went through there. They recorded those records in like a couple days and he ended up bouncing. And then, you know, then that whole thing turned into something sloppy. So that's a whole West Coast thing. Now, who is this nigga? Because it wasn't like I was popping like, oh, yeah, that's that nigga from, you know, that was slinging, that's going platinum in the Bay. Like, oh, we know that nigga. They don't know who the fuck I am. You see what I'm saying? And it was, and I got fast tracked into this situation. And it was weird. You know what I'm saying?
All right.
So it felt like it was still kind of, and it's, you know, real nigga shit. It's like, all right, I don't know this nigga either. Kind of feel this nigga out.
Feel your vibe.
So that's, I understand what you're saying. So, but that was that energy. But I'm different. I'm still wet behind the ears. You know what I'm saying?
You're also not from the streets.
Right.
You acknowledge that you're not from the streets, and the personalities is different. Like, and G-Money could speak on this. I don't want to take over this because I definitely want his opinion.
Yeah.
What I'm saying is that when we look at things completely different. Like, when somebody new come around, like, this nigga corny. Like, this is corny. I say, man, this corny nigga, man. Ain't about nothing. Yeah, who the fuck is it? You know what I mean? You probably laughing too extra. Probably trying to. I don't know the personality that you presented to them niggas.
I'll tell you. Let me give you a story.
Sure.
Because, I'm happy to be here. I'm wet behind the ears. You know what I'm saying? What's happening? Like, I have no reason to be mad, angry. Like, what are we doing here? So check this out. So you remember the Mobb Deep mixtape release party at the mansion? Remember that?
Mm-hmm.
And they had the buses of the strippers come and all that.
I remember that.
All right, so all the goons there, you know what I'm saying? They had all the DJs there. You know what I'm saying? And the strippers, the goons, the DJs, right? So we're in the club area, right? So this just shows you who I was, right? Who I am. DJs playing, whoever's, you know, playing slaps, you know what I'm saying? The dance floor is completely empty, right? I think I'm back, like, drinking or something and, you know, or getting ready. I come down. All the strippers, all the goons, everybody standing on the side like this, just standing on the side, look, you know, the cliche shit, you know what I'm saying? The cliche, I'm like, what's wrong with these niggas? Right? I was like, man, fuck that. I walk out to the middle of the dance floor by myself. And I'm like, because I'm hella happy to be here. Like, this is a dream come true to me. I'm the only nigga in the middle of the dance floor just dancing, kicking it, right? One stripper comes out. So now I'm freaking her like, you know, like the junior prom, you know what I'm saying, doing the freak. Three more strippers come out. So now all the strippers come out, and I'm the nigga in the middle that they're dancing with. Because, you know, it takes a nigga to, you know the group theory thing. Like, everyone's terrified to step out that box. So it took the one nigga to come out. Then all the strippers came. Now I'm having the time of my life. And then one goon gets comfortable. He comes out. And then all of a sudden, the party's popping. You see what I'm saying? That was my personality in that whole thing. I probably would have been cool if I came through there and I just stood there and was like, hey, what's up, my nigga? What kind of gun you got? Like, but that ain't me. I was the total opposite. You know what I'm saying? But I feel like that energy, like you said, it wasn't, you know what I mean? Like, it wasn't the same. Yeah. It was weird.
Did you have a dorky energy? You say it was dorky?
Nah, far from a dork. So what? I'm not a dork.
I'm saying.
No, I would tell you, right? I'd be like, oh, yeah, I'm a dork. Like, I'm not.
But dorky energy is like overexcited. Like, oh, yeah.
No. Listen, I'm not corny. Okay. There's super gay. There's Mazaradi Fox. And then you have Nick Cannon. I'm not like that. You know what I mean? Yo. Oh, my God. No. Coming off the top of
you
the
said head, it already.
Man. I know, man. Come on, man.
You can't my God, man.
But you know what I mean. You know.
I get it.
You know
I get
what
it.
I mean.
Yeah. So shout out to Nick.
Nick Cannon's amazing.
Nick, get the bag.
But I'm just, worst stand-up, by the way. But.
Worst what?
His stand-up. It was so bad. The stand-up was bad.
Easy, man.
You
put a lot of people on. Stop it. Easy, man.
No. He's amazing. He's Jesus. But the stand-up was bad. So, but again, so if we're going, there's a scale of, from corny to Mazaradi Fox, to Nick gangster, not, meaning gangster.
Okay.
I'm a five, you know what I mean? I understand, I get it. Like, I go to the clink, I'm good. Like, I go, like, I.
It wasn't your thing that you portrayed. It wasn't you just being yourself.
Right, so some I niggas, wasn't.
Okay.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? So again, I'm still aware, and I'm still like, I understand it. And I didn't come in here like, hey guys, no, I'm not corny. Like, I'm not made out of corn. So they knew that. Like, I never had the like, oh, that nigga's a corny ass nigga. It's just, no, I'm just not no goon. I'm not fucking Lodi Mac. You know what I'm saying? Rest in peace.
Sound like me, man, pretty much.
You know what I'm saying?
I'm not corn, but I'm good.
That's what that was. So,
okay.
So lay the corn to rest.
Let's lay the corn to rest. Pardon me. So that happened with the girl, you get kicked out.
Yeah.
Then Fox said this about
my.
Your man, yeah, all everybody leave.
We all got X'd.
Except for Hov. Hov was still there.
I think Hov was still there.
Yeah. Okay.
I think Hov was still there. Yeah. So I think like Hov would get sent home and come back. Like, he would, you know. And that's why, again, I think that was just another situation. It was just like, oh, okay, I can't afford to have another strike against me, so let me blame it on this punk ass nigga. And me, I'm far from a slime, you know what I'm saying? So it's just always surprising to me when I run into slime balls, you know what I'm saying? Because, like, I'll take my shit on the chin, you know? And so whenever someone could look you in your face and do that, I was just like, oh. But it was just a part of, like, the industry. Like, I was like, oh, okay, you know, that's how these people move. You know what I'm saying? So I just always, it's just hard. You know, when you're not a grimy nigga and then you meet niggas that do grimy shit, you're just like, wow, that's crazy.
You know, but it's a lesson learned.
Oh, 100%. And I love it. Like, because, like you say, you add that to, you don't let it turn you into a, you know, spiteful ass nigga. Like, you don't let it turn into a monster, but you just take that game in. And then, you know.
So you go home. The last time you go home, and then you went to do the show.
Do the show. Yeah, so we do the show.
Sign the paperwork?
Sign the paperwork. Mm. I don't know if it was the next day or whatever, but came back out here to New York, signed the paperwork. And that's when it was like, okay, now we're going to release the single. And because the paperwork's now signed, we got to figure this shit out. Mm. So that's when I'm going to LA now. Now I'm in Interscope. Now we're talking about what songs we're going to release and all that, right? So, yo, this shit was, mind you, we had the songs already. So, all right, we go to LA to go meet up with Jimmy Iovine. So we go to, like, in Beverly Hills, we go to his suite, and Pitty was like, yo, I got to play the album for you so we can figure out the single, right? So we go down to the Bulletproof. So now I'm in the back seat of the Bulletproof, and the seats, like, you could face each other, you know, with Jimmy Iovine, 50 Cent. And I'm like, wow, this is crazy to me. Like, Jesus Christ. So they're playing the music. And they're like, all right, okay, cool. So now I have, you heard Chase the Cat, right, with 50 on the hook. That's what I wanted to be the first single. I was like, that's a no-brainer, right? Because the club record, you know what I'm saying? So after we go through the album, Jimmy Iovine goes, go back to number 7, which is Be Easy. Now, at that time, Olivia was on the hook, right? You know Olivia? Or okay.
All I do is cry, silly. Woo!
So
shout out to Olivia.
Yeah, shout out to Olivia. So that was like the
you said it like that, nigga. You had something to do with Olivia, nigga?
What you mean?
I don't know, nigga. You smiled a little too hard.
Nah.
Okay, keep going.
There's a lot going on with all that. Rumors and all that shit. Not with me, but anyways, so he says go back to that. So inside my heart, I'm going, this doesn't make sense to me. Like, why? Nah, man, not that. You know what I'm saying? But again, 24-5-year-old me sitting in the back seat with these niggas, but you know, so in my head, I'm going, oh, they must know better than me, right? Huge mistake, right? Like, you know who, you know what you are as an artist, right? You should speak your mind, right? So he's like, we should do that one because that one has a better feel and blah, blah, blah. So in my head, I'm going, say something, nigga, like, tell them, like, you're the artist. Like, tell them. Like, not, like, this and that. But again, so in that situation, I was being ran by fear, right? Fear to fuck up. Fear to lose the situation. Fear to say something wrong. Fear to question, you know, those, you know, the powers, you know. Which obviously, you know, when you look back, you know, that's whack. You should always be, you know, lead with, what's going on in your mind, like what you want to do. So I didn't say anything. And at the end of that meeting, they just, you know, decided that Be Easy was going to be the first single, and I was hella sad. I was like, it don't make sense. It's too slow. You know what I'm saying? Like, even though we're going to put Mary J. Blige on it, you know, that came about. I was like, it don't make sense. Because Chase the Cat is a club record. I'm supposed to be the new young energy. Like, if that came out, that's an immediate banger, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. But my dumb ass don't say nothing. And it's not a regret, because things happen, you know, and, you know, you go through shit, and, you know, obviously you got to owe it to your experiences. But I felt a certain way about that for a long time. Not against anyone else, I'm saying for myself.
Right.
Like, why you didn't say nothing.
Because I didn't say nothing, you know. Like, now, you know what I'm saying, like, in who I am now, I would 100% say something like, hey, nigga. But, you know, that was 100 years ago. Now, it's like, all right, no, nigga, we need to do this. I'll more speak to, you know, speak as men, you know what I'm saying? Not as, oh, they're doing me a favor. Let me just listen to them because of this. When I knew in my heart what I should at least spoke on it. Even if they said, fuck you, nigga, we putting out Be Easy, I could live with that, you know what I'm saying, rather than just not say nothing at all. So that's when they decided on that, and that's what made Be Easy the first record.
And you was mad.
I wasn't mad.
It flopped?
Yeah, it couldn't stop flopping. Yeah, but you know, your mind tries to candy coat shit and makes things like, no, it's gonna be all right, you know. That's cool, you know. Mary J. Blige is on it; she's a legend, and so my mind was trying to trick me into like, oh, this is gonna work. But I knew deep down and that shit wasn't gonna work. I was like, this isn't gonna work. This doesn't. You can't play this in the club. And I ain't shit. Who am I? Like, I can't put out no regular, like, just a normal sounding record. Like, it has to at least bang in the club. You can't play that song in the club.
Right.
You know, it was a cool beat. It was a cool record, but that wasn't a, hey, the new first nigga signed to G-Unit in a while, and here's the first song to come out. You better be easy. I was like, nah, that don't make sense. So I wasn't surprised it flopped, but I thought I was going to get more chances. Mm. So I thought Chase the Cat would have came out next. You know what I'm saying? But once that flopped, you felt the air, go out of there. You know, oh, we just paid $100,000 to Mary J. Blige to be in this video and to do the record. And we pushed, we paid a bunch of money, towards radio promotions. And I don't know how much money they spent. Now, mind you, this is in that transition period. Now, remember, this is... YouTube is just now, I think the Soulja Boy is just now, like Soulja Boy was kind of coming out.
Yeah.
This is how long ago this was. So remember this, like I got a big advance, right? You don't get big advances being nobody now.
How much you got?
$250.
You was able to pay your restitution?
Oh, I got to go back to that. Oh. So... So I'm still on the run at this point, right? My probation officer has not called me yet. So I signed a deal. I signed the deal and the video was about to come out. We were premiering the video on... Was it TRL? It was one of those MTV shows. I think it was TRL.
Yeah.
My probation officer calls me.
Wow.
This nigga goes. He said, "Bro, where you at?" I was like, "Why? What's up?" He's like, "All right, listen. We're in the office, and my boss and everyone." So you're on TV in New York. What's happening? And I was like, oh yeah, I got some shit going on. But he was like, listen, I don't know what's going on, but I have to violate you. Cause his boss saw the MTV thing. Mm. I'm like, what? I was like, no, listen, I'm about to get this bread like next week. I'm about to pay this shit off. And he's like, yeah, I gotta violate you. So I fly back to SAC, and I go to jail for like 3 or 4 days or something like that, and then I get out, and I had to clean up the freeways and shit and like homeless camps.
Oh, damn.
for the community service. Mm-hmm. I had to do like 30 or 40 hours or something like that. So I had to do all that. As I'm doing that, or after I did all that. Then I got the money, flew back out to SAC, and I went to the probation office, and I had a check for the 48, whatever it was. And I remember I was like, hey, I need to put, I need to pay something on my restitution. And I never forget the lady. She was like, oh, yeah. She pulled it up. She's like, oh, okay, it's $48,000 something. I was like, here. She's like, how much you want to put on it? And I gave it to her. And she was like... Like, you could tell, she was like, what the fuck? Like, who's El Chapo ass nigga? What, like, who are you? Like, and she went to the back for how long? And she came back. She's like, you want a receipt? I was like, nigga, now you know I want a receipt. Now you know I want a receipt, nigga.
No mistakes with that.
Yeah, yeah. So she gave me a receipt. And she was like, wow, what's, And I kind of told her a little bit of the story. And she became a groupie.
Let's like, go! Hey.
But that was another moment, you know what I mean? Because that's what, remember, so go back, remember, I get out And I said, I have to get a record deal. I can't work for $10 an hour, pay this off. I can't pay no fucking, you know, used Mercedes Benz off, you know, working $10 an hour, you know, $50,000. Mm-hmm. So that was another moment. That was crazy.
So now Be Easy flops and you felt the air coming out. What happens next?
So this is 2000.
And what was the other G-Unit members? Yayo.
Yayo, Buck, Banks, Olivia, Spider, Mobb Deep. He had signed Mobb.
M.O.P.
M.O.P. Oh, I love M.O.P. I missed. Oh, man, M.O.P. Those some old uncle-ass niggas. I love them niggas. M.O.P.
I don't think Mace was signed at all, but Mace was around for a little bit.
That was before. That was kind of right before. And then Mace did that mixtape. He did that G-Unit Radio with Who Kid. And then Puff came out and said he wanted $2 million for him.
I remember that.
Remember that? And then 50 took offense to that. Like, really, nigga? Like, and then, you know, that whole thing didn't work out. Remember, they did the window shopper video. Remember Mason there and all that? But that was like before I came.
Rolling.
Oh, my God, nigga. That's still one of my favorites, nigga.
Summertime, wait, that was fire. Oh, my
God, nigga.
I'm going to listen to that when I leave. So, yeah, so the air came out. Come on. Okay. Hold on.
Turn up, G. When did you first meet Banks and Buck? And,
That's what I'm saying. There's so many intertwining. So
when did you meet them and how did they act to you when you met them? Because you said you're coming from Sacktown and how people were treating you. You know what I'm saying?
Amazing. That was good. Yeah, you're wonderful.
I was waiting, you know, had it in stash. Right?
Yeah, that was glorious. So where are we at? This is probably, I don't know if we had a show. This is probably like a few weeks in, right? I specifically remember meeting Banks because we were on I walked into it was a trailer? It was something. And Banks is already kind of, you know, kind of like a standoffish.
Shout out to Blue. Yeah, he is.
Yeah, shout out to Banks, man. But he had like the realest energy, like it was like real, like it wasn't like a, see, now that's the difference. So when I was talking about like the whole energy or the other energy from some of the other cats, it seemed more like catty-ish, and Banks was, it was like, you know, it was a shake-up. Oh, what's good, nigga? Like, oh, okay, yeah, kept it moving. But then later on it was like, oh, I fuck with this nigga, like, you know what I'm saying? It was cool. It was like, it just was a genuine. It was kind of like, all right, I'm not going to jump out the windows now. I'm going to shake up and be cordial with him, be, you know what I'm saying, say what's up. But then as time went on, we grew to be cool, you know what I'm saying? Not like buddy-buddy and all that shit, but cool. Like, yeah, you know what I'm saying? So Banks was always cool. Yayo was always cool. But, you know, Yayo moved with whatever the energy 50 was on. You know what I'm saying? So, we riding with this nigga? Oh, I'm riding with this nigga. You know what I'm saying?
Loyalty by default.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, we ain't riding with this nigga? Oh, what's the story on this nigga? Like, I know he would turn on me at the drop of a dime, you know what I'm saying, based on the energy. Not saying that's bad, but I just knew, I checked his temperature on that, right? But he was always cool. He was hella fun. And
solid,
you know,
yeah.
Solid. Yeah, great energy, man. Like, yeah, it was cool. Buck was just a live wire. Buck was always cool. Just a lot. You know, Buck was always in his own world and whatnot. But he was always cool, always respectful, always, you know, just being Buck. Spider, obviously, he was cool. It kind of came out later. Spider felt a certain way. Because Spider was supposed to come next. Right, so before 50 heard my shit, I guess Spider was supposed to be on deck. I mean, I don't know that. That's what he was, you know, with the Blutiful World and and all that. So again, that was all before me. But I guess he was supposed to come next. I pop up, now all of a sudden my album's getting green-lighted out of nowhere. There's a little bit of saltiness in that too. I didn't know that until I saw an interview later on. It was like, oh yeah, the Hot Rod came out of nowhere. And there was a bunch of salt. I'm telling you, there was salt coming. Some nigga out of nowhere just comes in, and now all of a sudden his album's gonna come out. Now he's got Mary J. Blige on the record. Cause then when it started slowing down, right, that's when niggas like, so now at that point, when the record comes out and flops, right, now the attention starts getting shady, you know what I'm saying? Now the, you know, niggas' phones aren't working, you know, the handshakes go from, oh, what's up, nigga, oh, yeah, to, oh, what's up, nigga, the little soft, you know, the little soft hand, the little butter hand, you're like, oh, shit, that nigga ain't fucking me no more. So it started getting to that little, you know, like, oh, you ain't got no budget no more, nigga. Like, what's... So now it got to that point where I was kind of, like, fending for myself, like, trying to, like, put out mixtapes. And it wasn't like, here's itineraries, you're going to L.A. now you're doing this. That just slowed up, right? And again, we shot other videos and shit, but it just, I don't know, they just didn't want to, I guess, put any more money behind it. So during all that, so that's when the vibe started getting real shady. You know, when I was in the office or seeing niggas. And then, I don't know what year it was, but like Yayo did an interview with, was it Vlad? Are you pulling shit up?
Yeah.
It's like a Vlad Yayo. And like, they asked him, and he was like, this nigga. And he even said something greasy. Oh, this nigga, they gave this nigga Mary J. Blige record with that Dre beat. And that nigga fucked that up. And I'm like, yo, these niggas, why are they talking? These niggas is okay, but it's like seeing very like weird salt. Like, it just, I feel I got put into a position. I feel like people didn't feel I earned it. That was the vibe. So then as soon as, but 50 was like rocking with me tough. So then it was weird because he's the general, you know? So then it's like, I hate this nigga, but I can't really show it. So once the shit started to fizzle, you know what I'm saying? That's when, like, niggas start showing, you know, their little true colors, you know. Which, you know, that's how it's supposed to go, I guess. But, yeah.
When you get the Jigun and Tat, when you get that?
Yeah, I got this in Germany in, I think it was 2007. I got it. And I figured, I was like, I had this was like a huge moment in my life. Like, it was, I had to get this. Like, it was like, you know, this was like, a reminder. Like, yo, this is like a moment. You know what I'm saying? So when I was out in Germany, I was like, yeah, I got to get this. So I just got it. Because everyone had one too. So no one told me to get it or anything. It wasn't like, hey, you have to get this.
Everyone had one.
Yeah, yeah. They didn't say that. So it wasn't like a thing, so I got it while I was on tour. So when shit slowed down, right, so at this point, so I'm moving with my people, with my Greek crazy Greek niggas, and there's a song, I had a song, it's called I Like to Fuck, right? It wasn't a typical, it was like a, you know, are you familiar?
Yeah.
Yeah, we listening, man.
Okay. No, I don't know. Shit, you know, yeah. So again, you know, that was like a clubby, you know, record. Now that record, so after shit slowed down, now that record was there. Uh-huh. Interscope got excited again. They're like, yo, because they're playing that shit in Interscope. They're like, yo, this is the next record. We got to put this shit out. This is going to pop off, blah, blah. Now, remember, let's go back. This is, YouTube ain't popping. Like, this is, the record industry is trying to figure out what's happening right now with the leaking of music, LimeWire, you know, all that shit. YouTube and the streaming, the industry has no idea what's happening. So they're trying to figure this out, this record out. We decide, because remember the third verse wasn't always Tila Tequila, right? It was just like a the producer had did like a had some other girl on it. So we were like, so at this time we were like, who we gonna put on the third verse? So it's funny, we reached out to Nicki Minaj at this time. This is obviously before she was. We reached out to Kim Kardashian because at this time she was, I think she was kind of, I think the sex tape came out. Like we were trying to like play it, you know what I mean? Lil Kim, somebody else. But we ended up going with Tila Tequila. Y'all remember MySpace? Remember she was like the MySpace whore, like back in those days. So we're like, you know what? This makes more sense. It's more of like a parody, like fun, whatever. Let's get her. So we're trying to iron the details out. She does her part. They're dragging their feet. The song leaks. Right? The label goes, oh shit. So the song's leaking and getting hella views. Interscope and them go, oh, the song's dead. It leaked. It has no more value. This is what their mind, because remember, again, this is 2000, I think this was late 2007, maybe early eight or something. And they were like, oh, we just can't, nah, it's dead. We can't. But again, no one knew. We didn't know. They didn't know what they were talking. Now you want to leak shit to get it out. So it just shows the different mentality that the labels, they didn't know what was happening. That record had like 50, 60 million between girls dancing to it, people just uploading to YouTube. Like it was a crazy fucking song, and they dropped the ball on that, mm-hmm. right? So I get hella sad again. You know what I'm saying? This is where you're supposed to have the Price is Right horn. The wink, wink, wink. Yeah, that's supposed to be that. So I was hella sad again. Back to the drawing board. Now, mind you, with that, so even though it leaked, I still was promoting it. And, you know, so Olivia booked a tour with Who Kid. Okay. They hit me up. Either they hit me or I hit them. And they're like, yo, you want to go on this tour? I was like, yeah. They're like, we can't pay you, but, you know, you can come and open up for us and whatever, right? I was like, cool. Go on a tour. So I go out there to network, right? I meet the promoters and, you know, all that shit. And it was like a week tour, and it was Germany. I meet the promoters, and that was my introduction into touring. Because I toured for like 6 or 7 years on my own, right? Just off the name and off of the shit. You know, they wasn't fucking me no more. But I'm still genuine, you know what I'm saying? So I used that to tour. So I toured the whole world by myself, right? Even ran into, like, I was in Turkey one time, and 50 and them was out there. And I ran up on there. I ran up in their little thing. And there was always this, like, respect that 50 had for me, right? Because he was like, because I wasn't asking him for anything. Like, I wasn't like, hey, like, I was like, all right, fuck it, like, let me just move around. And I'm obviously documenting all that, but I was moving around on my own accord. I wasn't just waiting on him. And he even mentioned that in a meeting one time. He's like, y'all fuck with this nigga because he's hustling, like, he's moving, like, without a record, without anything, he's still figuring it out. You know what I'm saying? Even if I'm only getting $2,500 a show or five, you know, I'll take a show for $1,000 or this and that. But it was just me getting around trying to figure it out. So in that, as I'm touring, which is, let's say, 2008, 9-ish, 8 to 13, whatever, just touring. So now this is just, I'm paying my damn bills by touring. I'm rapping, but all these clubs are playing house music, right? Because this is overseas Europe. So all they shit was, so I'm like, you know, and I'm seeing these big ass clubs and how they rocking. And so I'm getting the bright idea. I'm like, you know what? This is before Akon, and you know what I'm saying, ooh, she's a sexy bitch, and Pitbull, and this is like before all that, right? And remember, it shifted over to that whole mute, that dance shit. So I'm doing that. I'm like, you know what? So I was taking some of the big records, and I would put vocals on them, and then give them to the DJs out there, and that fueled my touring, right? Because they were playing my house-ish type records over there, and then coupling it with shows, and then using G-Unit name. So that was my hustle till I was going out doing that. So then I'm like, you know what? I should start making that type of music. I'm trying to chase a hit. I'm trying to get back in the building now. Now, mind you, the last record was I Like to Fuck, which was a kind of an up-tempo type of record. And I was like, you know what? Let me try to go with that vibe. So I started making that kind of music, right? Which kind of leads us into the Mike Knox situation. Oh, did you want to talk about that?
I'm waiting for you to, you know, you.
I'm waiting for you to cut me off because you be having me weak. Yo, you be having me. You go slow down. Look, slow down.
I'm trying to hear where you're going with this.
All right, so. Oh, we got to talk. I know you're going to talk about London because that was before this, too.
Well, when you get to go off the stage?
Yeah, we got to talk about London, too.
What happened?
See, you got to keep me on track because I'm time jumping.
Shouldn't time jump, man.
But this is...
Because you're going into a story and then you're going into a story and then you're time jumping, but it all lines up. It don't seem like you're time jumping.
But my brain is putting all this together and I'm going, shit.
Tell me what happened in London.
Okay, yeah. Okay. All right, so London. Yo, okay. All right, so London. So this is 2007, I believe. And 50 hadn't done a show in a while, right? I'm at the office and they're talking about, oh yeah, we got the show, blah, blah. I just happened to go by the office, like just whatever. And they were talking about Yayo can't, they're like, hey, Yayo can't get into London. He can't get in there. They won't let him in, blah, 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 right? And then 50 was like, wait, what? He said, put Rod on it. And I'm like, oh shit. He was like, give him the set list. And this is the next day. So I'm like, okay. So I'm gonna be the hype man. So I'm taking Yayo's spot, right? Never performed with these niggas, or, you know, never done this, right? This nigga print out the set list. Like, it was like 30, 40 songs or something, right? Now, if you've seen a 50 show, like, he'll say the first, I'll tell you to the, and he'll stop, and you have to say that fucking second half of that line, right? So you gotta know you have to know these songs. I'm like, man, this is a tough challenge, right? But I was like, fuck it, I can figure this out. So I stay up all night, you know, listen to all the records. But I was really psyching myself out. It was pressure, you know what I'm saying? This is at the Hammersmith in London, for like 5,000 people, I think. So I'm like, all right, so I'm learning it. Next day come, we fly out there. I'm still, you know, trying to learn this shit. We get there. So now we're in the green room. And I'm like, who was it? I forget who was there with me. I don't know if Banks was there. Was Yale? I mean, was Banks? Somebody was there. Was Hove there? Yeah, there was a group of niggas. But I remember specifically, I was like, yo, I need something to drink. I need to take the edge off. You know what I'm saying? And whoever it was, that was like, nah, 50 don't like when niggas be drinking, you know, before the, like, nigga, he don't like that. And I was like, mind you, there's hella liquor. As I saw, there was liquor that was in the, and I'm like, I need to take the edge off right now. I'm tripping right now. Like, I didn't say that out loud, but in my head I was like, man, all right, I guess I'm gonna try to do this sober. Worst move. So they're like, all right, count down to the show. So go out there. I run out. I do the intro. We already rehearsed the intro and all that. Intro's cool. You know, unit. Yeah. I've got the crowd hype. You know what I'm saying? It's popping. The energy good. I'm like, oh, hell yeah. This is the, you know, I'm getting, kind of getting into the groove. 50 come out. Everybody's tripping. I'm like, oh, my God. This is the greatest time of my life. So I'm starting to get the, you know, the jitters, you know, starting to go away. You know what I'm saying? And I forget the song, the list. Oh, no, it was What Up Blood, right, when he came out. Simple. Now, I do that, like, you know. And then I forget what the next song was. But then we got to
Wanksta.
Jinx.
Come on, man. Everybody know Wanksta, man.
You ain't a friend of mine. Ain't oh, a kin my mine. God. It makes you think that I won't run up on you with the nine. Do this all the time. Right now we on the grind.
Oh, you just gonna show everybody you know
Nicks
all the words.
Down. Show that she's so fine. Gotta make her mind. Ass like that. Gotta be one of a kind. Crush him every time. Punch him with every line. I'm fucking with their mind. I make them press rewind. They know they can't shine if I'm a. Been on parole since 94 cause I commit the time. I send you my. I did a 3-9. The D's ran up in my crib. You know who dropping dimes. What's wrong with you? Damn, homie. In high school, you was the man, homie. The fuck happened to you? I got the sickness when it comes to my nigga, you play with my paper. You gon' meet my Beretta. Now, shorty think I'm a sweater. I'm sipping on a Beretta. I might hit once Tendetta. I know I could do better. She look good. But I know she after my cheddar. She tryna get in my pocket, homie. And I ain't gon' let it be easy.
Stop that bullshit to get your whole crew wet.
We in the club the same old two-step. You in the club and say we bogged out. What the fuck? You ain't know that, nigga? How dare you, nigga?
No, the worst part is...
Get that nigga, G.
Yo, nigga, the worst part was I fucked up on the hook.
Yeah, that's pretty... I mean,
that was bad, man.
I messed up some of the words just now on the verse, but...
You can't afford to mess up when... So what it sounded like was I would blank... He was saying, and it would just be blank, so it sounded hella stupid. Like it sounded like it was stupid. Mm. You know, Yayo, he'd be like, well, we never pop next. So you know, he's the greatest hype man of all time. So I was just fucking up, and I knew I was like, yo, I'm wilding. So I was like, nigga, the mic tripping. You know what I'm saying? The mic. You know what I'm saying? Because he's walking by, he's like looking at me, right? And he was like, kind of like, you know, like nigga, like he can't. You know what I mean? Mm. Like, what's happening? It's like the mic. So I was like, I need another mic. You know what I'm saying? To go back. They give me another mic. I'm like, yeah. Still fucking up though. Now I'm just spiraling downward, right? It was a bad situation. It was bad, right? I'm like, wow. I look hella stupid right now. This is in front of all these people. Like, now my mind just started going, right? And I'm like, and he stopped. He was like, hold on. Stop. Stop the music. Stop that shit, nigga. He was like, when he walked over and he grabbed the mic, he was like, get the fuck out of here. He was like, get the fuck off the stage. I got hella sad. I was like, oh, why is this happening? Like, what? Wow, like, oh, shit, why is this happening to me right now? This is a good thing because this wasn't, like, if this was today, like, I would have been plastered, like, all over. Like, this was still, again, remember, let's go back to the time. This still wasn't,
right.
This was MySpace and, you know, those days. So I didn't get too much of too much heat, you know what I'm saying? So I walked to the back feeling hella, like if I had a tail, it would have been like between my legs, where I was hella sad. And I walked back and I'm mad, right? I'm like, you know what I'm saying? Cause I felt disrespected too, you know, as a man, but I was whacked though, I fucked up. But I still felt, you know, like, he just kicked me off stage and said, get the fuck off the stage in front of all these people. So I go to the back. So now I'm just standing in the back of the stage. And he's performing. So he did a hella tight because he was like, oh, these mics work. Like he was taking both the mics. He was like, yeah. And he started like performing with both the mics. Oh, God. I was like, yo, this thing is hella tight. Because it looked hella tight. He was doing it. And then he was like, if I can't do it, he said something, these mics work. You know what I'm saying? If I can't do it. And then he dropped, and they dropped, if I can't. it was the greatest transition I ever. I like turned back into a fan for like 9 seconds, and then I got mad again. I was like, "Fuck that nigga," because that shit, it was hella tight how he did it though. It was like some smoothest. I'm like, this nigga's a professional. So now I'm back there, standing back there with everybody, and then out of nowhere, then this nigga takes water and splashed it back on me, and I got hella mad. I was like, because I just thought it was over. I was like, oh, fuck this. Yeah, that. I was like, wow. Like, I was about to, and then I want to say Hove was there, because Hove actually calmed. He was like, he calmed me down. He was like, yo, no, just chill, nigga. Nah, he just, nigga, you just got to go through this. And then, I really respect the Hove for that. Like, it was something I didn't expect from him. But he was like, yo, no, just chill. Because I was livid. I was like, you know what I'm saying? Like, super livid. He was like, nah. And then I finally, like, calmed down, you know, got my ego in check. And, you know, owned the fact that I fucked up. Went through with the show. You know, just watched it from the back. And then show was over. We go to the back, to the green room. And then Fifth pulled me to the side. You know what I'm saying? He was like, look, you know, grabbed me like a little, you know, little brother, like big brother. He was like, look, man, you know, don't take it personal. You know what I'm saying? I had to, you know, but, you know, you got to be on your game. And, like, this is a hard business. And, you know, he's not a psychopath. You know, he has a little bit of psychopathicness, but he's not crazy. He's like, he knew how to do the punch hug. Like, he did the punch hug. You know, he made it right. You know what I'm saying? Kind of, like, to where I wasn't, you know. Going off the deep end, but he was just like, yo, you just had to, you know, you got to learn from the situation, you got to be prepared, and this was, you know, basically, it was like a test, like, could you step up to the stage, like, you know what I'm saying, and you fucked up, so, but nah, it's all good, and da-da-da, smoothed it over, it was cool, and, yeah, and that was that.
I mean, did he expect you to learn all those songs in a day?
He ain't tell the nigga he ain't know the songs, it's his fault. He should have spoke. You wouldn't be all cool and just, no. I don't know the record.
But that opportunity.
You're right. Opportunity, man.
That opportunity, I ain't turning down.
But again, but you got, you right? But you're thinking, you don't wanna disappoint. I'm the new nigga. Yeah. Hey, man, I don't know the songs. What? In my head, you bitch ass nigga. You're like, oh, I thought you was, you see what I'm saying? So it's like, nah, let me step up to the plate. So I do see what you're saying. I see, but like.
Damn, homie. In high school, you was the man, homie.
What the fuck happened to you, nigga?
That was one of the most fierest. I got the sickness vendetta when it come to the... Oh, my God.
That's what I got.
He did it again. He's back.
He said, Cheddar. Yeah, yeah. He said,
Cheddar. He's back.
He said, Cheddar, nigga. He said, Cheddar.
So, go ahead. Wow. Right, so,
oh, my God. But that was
wow.
Like,
That's a.
But he spoke to you after that.
Yeah, he spoke to me after that.
So okay, so let's. So the thing you was up to before was you put your vocals on these EDM records.
Yeah.
And they're playing it now. It's booking now. Then what happens?
So then I started making. So I started transitioning and started making pop records, like my own records,
like a Flo Rida type thing.
Very Flo Rida-y, Pitbull-y.
Mm-hmm.
But this was, again, this was like before.
Before Pop.
Was this before them? Was it? I think it wasn't like.
Apple Bottom Jean.
Yeah, what year was that? Because this was. I think this was before.
That's what was a hit.
It was a slap. Nah, actually, yeah, that was.
That's still be going on.
Whoa, that was a fire record.
Nah, I said it's still.
Yeah, no, I'm saying, whoa, yeah.
That was huge.
Whoa.
That was a huge fucking record.
That record came out in 2008.
Yeah. So eight. I remember hearing that record. Actually, I remember hearing that record at one of the DJ conferences. I remember that before he dropped it. But I didn't think of that as... But see, that was pop, but I didn't think of that as house.
I got what you're saying. Yeah,
you see what I mean? Yeah, like, it was like... It was still... You know what I'm saying? Like, okay, I was doing dance. Like, you know what I'm saying? because I was chasing that hit or chasing a, you know, but trying to be different with it. And so I started making those kind of records. And I went up to the office with, I think I had like 3 records maybe or something like that. Or maybe we had like 5 records or something. And we started playing them. And it was like, and well, I think it was Nelson. Y'all know Nelson, right? Nelson. Mm-hmm. And then Nelson called Phipps like, yo, this nigga Rod. So at this point, I'm just touring. Mm-hmm. And
you got kicked out of the group?
Not kicked out. I'm just...
You just wasn't with them anymore.
Yeah, I was just, you know, it was just me. And I was like, all right, I'm not going to ask them. I'm just touring. And then I need to come up with some records. So I took the dance route, went up to the office, played those records. And the office was like, yo, this shit is crazy. Like, it's like some crazy, it's like, it's in that dance, you know. I'm still rapping, but it's like dance production type mm-hmm. of thing. And I'm like, yo, I'm touring off of this shit. Like, I Like the Fuck didn't come out. That was up tempo. Let's try to keep that same vibe. Like, obviously, I'm not going to put no more money behind me on this. I didn't say that, but you know. But so here's a new, fresh, you know, reinvent, you know, vibe. So that got me back in the building. It was like, oh shit, this shit is crazy. Because 50 heard him and he was like, yo. And he was already, I think he already had G Note. So that's when that G Note records came. So he was like, okay, to separate this from G Unit, I can have the G Note. So that made, so we started to put those records out under G Note. Right? So that was that whole thing. So I became like the face of that. That's why I had like Dance With Me and Hot Girl and all that shit. So they put, you know, some money behind that. It was cool. And I actually like hit the charts with some couple of the records, but it still didn't turn into shit. But that, so that was my dance music type of transition. But it started with the I Like the Fuck record, you know what I'm saying? Where that was up tempo and whatnot. But yeah.
But so that, you work with David Guetta also, right?
Yeah, David Guetta.
Around the same time when these records are coming out?
Yeah, so when I went into that lane, like 50 was supporting it. So, you know, he was using his name and, you know, all these house dudes, like these big house record guys, like they all wanted to meet 50 and all that. So, like, we got in the studio with, like, David Guetta, with, like, Chucky and A-Track, like all these big, like, house DJ producers right. and all that. So I did a few records with him. None of them got released. But yeah, did some joints with him. He's a cool cat.
Yeah, he's fine. He
got yeah, some huge. Yeah. So
go ahead.
Yeah. So that kind of brings me to the Mike Knox situation. How did that even come up? Oh, because he was talking about he was supposed to be signed. He said they had a budget and I don't know how true that was. I don't know if he was just like there's a budget and it was out of me and him. Like I don't know, because I don't know where that information came from. But and then he was like, oh yeah, he's a bozo. And I was like, well, why is he money? Because people sent me that. That's you remember, that's why I hit you. I was like, yo, mm-hmm. And he's like, you be having me weak. He was like, come on, man. Like, what, like why? So oh, he's a bozo. Like, he was rapping street shit. And I was never a street rapper, by the way. And then he went to dance music and da da da. So I kinda, I don't know if I'll use the word bozo, but I did, when I was doing that, I wasn't doing what I wanted, like from the heart. You see what I'm saying? Like there was a BET Awards where Flo Rida was sitting in the audience, right? Now Flo Rida's Flo Rida. He's made $1 trillion. You know, he's the pop, whatever. Remember, he didn't come out like that, right? He came out birthday cake. Remember that? That he was hard. And not saying he's not now, but he was like, but he flipped it to that, just like Pitbull did, right? But I remember seeing, yeah, made hella money. Now Flo Rida, he was sitting in the audience at the BET Awards, and like 2 Chainz is getting hella awards, and Wayne, and you know what I'm saying, like all the niggas is rapping. I remember they like showed him, and I remember just him sitting there, and it just looked like his eyes were hella sad. Like he, like, cause you know he wasn't gonna get no awards, mm-mm, right? He's gonna get the pop awards and all that. But you knew, you know, Flo Rida was a, like, you know what I'm saying? So what, he made a ton of money. I did it. I didn't. I failed. You know, I didn't succeed at that. And I felt like, you know what? Like, that was, I'd rather have failed at doing, I should have stuck to what I was doing. Like, I'd rather have failed doing what I want to do. Because I didn't like performing those records. You know what I'm saying? Like, that wasn't me. Like, I was just doing that because I thought it was marketable. Mm-hmm. You see what I'm saying? And so when he said I was a bozo, like, I could easily be like, oh, fuck that nigga. You know what I'm saying? But I see, when he said that, I identified with that. You see what I'm saying? Like, how you gonna go from this to this? You see what I'm saying? So, again, I was triggered when he first said it. But I was like, you know what? I see what he's saying. I see where he's coming from. Because I did feel a certain way when I look back on that, by chasing something that I didn't really want to, you know, it wasn't me at my heart. I rap. I'm not that dance music nigga. But it paid, you know, touring and all that paid the bills, which was great. But that's, looking back on that situation, I did, you know, feel that way. About that.
That's why you hit me up.
Yeah, you know I hit you. But I.
So you don't feel no way about what he said like that, like, you know, him calling.
Nah. I don't.
You feel didn't that. Take it.
No, initially, I did, and that's why I hit him. But I didn't hit him and say, like, oh, yeah, I'm going to come on there. I told you, I was like, I ain't coming there on no beef or nothing like
that.
I was like, nah. I just felt like it would be a good time, like, if you're, you know, interviewing him and my name did come up. And I'm like, you know what? And I haven't even told my side of the story. No one's heard this shit. Like,
right.
So it was just kind of, it was a perfect segue, you know, to go into it. So, nah, it was no... No beef. I mean, obviously, it was a disrespectful word, you know what I'm saying, calling nigga a bozo.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, he's trying to have a good time.
All right, so you got the dance records out. The G-Note label's going.
So G-Note's happening. Remember, he signed Pauly D.
That's right.
Remember that?
That's
so
right, he did.
We were moving around. So it was fun. It was like a fun time.
Mm-hmm.
But nothing really took off. It was uncharted territory. Like, G-Unit, you know, it wasn't like a pop label or anything like that. You know what I mean? So it was cool. It was like, it just didn't take off. It just kind of fizzled again. It fizzled off again.
So what did that leave you now?
What you mean? Now as in today?
No, I mean, in that situation. Like, what?
Oh, okay. So, what year is this?
Hold on. You gotta ask him the serious question.
No, I'm gonna get to it. I wanna see
man,
why,
come on, man. Ask me the question now, nigga. What y'all talking about?
Hey, I'm
over here
G.
trying to.
Nah, yeah, no.
G the OG. Yeah.
Oh, the OG.
Come on, OG.
OG money.
I wanna know what happened next. Now, that didn't work out. Oh. It sizzled down.
You still. Go straight to the.
I'm gonna get to it. I wanna see what he said. All right. Let's see what he said. Then I wanna ask him. That was my plan.
I'm waiting. You got this.
Yeah, because he tells a great story. So
he does, but I want to get you. Yeah, do your thing, bro.
Yeah, so.
Stop blinking. Like, you're going to talk for another hour. Watch.
All right.
Nah, all right. But that's, y'all got to direct me because I'm just freestyling.
All right.
So you can't, you know what I mean?
They
so
said
I,
50 slapped
so
you.
So I could be missing shit.
They said 50 slapped you in the crib.
No.
Over some crackers.
Over some crackers.
That's what I heard. That's what the story. We had to ask you to see what your version is.
Come on, man. So, now that wasn't even the 50 slap story. There's a bunch of slap stories, right? None of them happened.
None of them happened?
No. You never got slapped by 50?
No. The one that I heard, it was some nigga named Carcino something. If you Google Carcino something, he was a nigga that got hella views saying I got slapped at the show. Mm. Which is not true. None of that's
well, true. The story that I heard online, and you know, we had to clear it up today. The story that I heard is he had a particular cracker that he was his crackers, and you were just didn't know, and you kind of was getting down with it, and you know what I'm saying. And then he walked in, and he was like, "Yo, like, what's up?" And he slapped everything out of you.
Nah, that's hella untrue. Yeah, that's hella entertaining. Nah, that never happened.
Did 50 ever hit you before, honestly? Did you ever have a sock being pushed in the stage?
The only time thing that happened was the water thing that I told you at the show.
So where did somebody come with a story that you got slapped in the face unconsciously?
Let me pull up Hot Rod Says Fuck G-Unit. This is going to answer your question. Pull that up on YouTube. Hot Rod Says Fuck G-Unit.
Oh, easy. Easy.
No. Pull that up. And it's going to look like some nigga laying on a couch. Like a trap couch. Like a little.
Yeah. Hot Rod.
Click on that and listen to it.
Who the hell is this?
Exactly.
That's supposed to be you?
It's not me, but that's. Listen.
You know what I'm saying? She's crazy, man. But you know what I'm saying? I'm getting my own bread right now, baby. I'm doing my own thing, baby. Coming out. You know what I'm saying? Look out for that.
All right. What's this about?
Shit like that was happening. Niggas was making full videos, making shit up about me, like, for views and stories. Like that Carcino nigga. Making whole videos of shit just to get views. Because remember, at a certain point, like, I was super hot, mm-hmm. right? Being on this label. So there was this hella, like, just little stupid shit going around, like that. Like, if a nigga gonna sit there. And, yo, what's so funny was that nigga made that. I remember being in New York, and niggas was asking me about that. And I remember, we were about to link up and go to one of the shows that we weren't invited to. And I remember we walked up, and this was when that shit came out. And I remember Monster. I remember there was like rumblings of like, yo. And I remember he looked at me. He was like, yo, what's the word on this nigga? Like, they really thought that was me. They really thought like that was really causing some like a rift. And then they found out it wasn't. But I never forget. It was like that. It was, I'm like, yeah, no, niggas really thought that was me. But niggas was doing shit like that. Like, like what? So to your question, so you asked me, you said, what would make a nigga make up a cracker story? What would make a nigga lay on the couch
and make a video? Guy, that said G-Unit Fraud Hot Rod Exposed.
Yeah, there's maybe like five or
who's
six.
Who's this guy, though?
I don't know, man.
Jax exposed Hot Rod from G-Unit and informs the public of his falsehood. Who's Jax?
I don't know.
You know this nigga.
I don't know these niggas. Yeah. What? How? I don't.
No paperwork yet. You know what I mean? I ain't even seen no numbers yet. You can be telling me to come roll with you, nigga, for $50 a week, nigga.
I don't know these niggas.
You told him to roll with you. Stop acting like you don't know this nigga. Ain't no nigga gonna make no story like this. Look at this nigga. Let me just refresh your memory.
No,
I'm violating. Let me refresh your memory. This nigga right here, Jax, nigga.
I don't know that
man,
nigga.
Yeah. Man, you violated. Yeah. I don't know. Look at Jax, nigga. Look at Jax.
I don't know that nigga.
Stop lying. What happened with you and Jax?
I don't know him.
He said you tried to. You ain't gonna violate my man, Jax.
Yo, has my lips been dry this whole time?
Nah, yeah, they dry, nigga. Don't
they be feeling like the Dave Chappelle cocaine lips.
Don't let your lips get dry.
But
now,
I don't
nigga.
Know that nigga.
How you.
Quit my job, 50. Sorry, 50. So now 50 got him on the road with him. You know what I mean?
Okay.
He's just
telling the story.
These
okay,
people,
got it.
They would send me these videos, and I'm like, what? But these are hating ass niggas. They're just, they're doing it for the clout, for the views, and yeah. But for the record, never got slapped by 50 Cent. 50 Cent's never hit me. None of that's ever happened.
Gotcha.
The cracker story is hella funny. I don't think I ever heard that. But the only slap story I heard was the nigga that took the London story and added and said, oh, then 50 went back there and slapped him. Mm-hmm. I heard that one. And that was false. But I never heard the crackers. The crackers is hella funny, by the way.
That's crazy.
To make that very clear.
So you never got touched by 50?
Never.
You got touched by anybody in G-Unit?
No.
You ever had a scuffle with anybody in G-Unit?
No.
Okay.
Never had a scuffle. I was with Buck in Vegas when the game was there, and that whole thing was about to go down. That was like a little standoff thing. I was there at the Saigon thing. The Saigon, the Mob Deep. Remember when
he punched somebody? He hit Prodigy.
Prodigy, yeah. Remember in Saigon was performing, was it like the Hot 97?
Something like that. Yeah, you was there?
Yeah, I was there with cause I was fucking with Nice and all them and the whole Mob crew. Shouts to Nice. Yeah, we was in the studio, we was all chilling, and there was like niggas got word Saigon was at the was the House of Blues. Mm. And niggas, like, we went down there, and you know that whole thing went down. So Saigon was on stage and that whole shit went down. You know what I'm saying? So I was there. I was on stage and all that shit went down. Man, I fell off the fucking stage because it started this big ass rumble. Fell off the stage, and then remember that's when Saigon got up out of there because it was a fucking crazy situation. Mm-hmm. But that was the most, back. Huh? Yeah, I think his security. That was a crazy situation. But that was probably the only like rough scuffle ish situation I was in. But it wasn't with me though. I came out of there unscathed, man. I didn't have any situations, man. Like I was very blessed to not have any situations. You know. So
just reading. So after all that happens, G note. Obviously, didn't go nowhere. What's the last thing? How does things fizzle out completely? How does G-Unit separate themselves from Hot Rod?
All right, so we put out a couple of those records. We put out Dance With Me. Then we put out Hot Girl. And then 50 hopped on the Hot Girl remix. Those were cool. And then they were like, yo, they wanted to put the album out, right? And they were like, yeah, so we want to put this album out and, you know, we're going to put it out. We'll give you this certain amount of money and da-da-da. And then I was like, I said no. I didn't want to put the album out because I was like, I wasn't feeling to put that whole dance music thing out. So they're like, all right, whatever. So I didn't put it out. And then after that, it just kind of like just went dark. You know what I'm saying? I started putting out some mixtapes and shit like that. And then it got to the point where it was like, all right, we're clearly not going to do business anymore. You know what I'm saying? And so I remember I reached out to Nikki Martin. She was, you know, she was the president at the time. And I was like, hey, you know, coming to you guys, you know, respectfully, you know, we're clearly not going to do anything together. You know what I'm saying? You know, can you see if it's cool to release me from any contractual agreements, you know, that we have, you know, in case I can get into another situation? You know, I'm asking you guys humbly, you know, if that's an option. You know, and like I said, everybody fuck with me. I was cool nigga. Like I was never wilding or anything like that. And you know, she came back. She was like, hey, you know, I talked to Fifth and it was cool. You know, we wash our hands, we separate, you know, from contracts and all that, and you're good. And I want to say this is like 2015, maybe.
14, wish you the best of luck in your future endeavors.
Yeah, it was like you know how they do at the casino? They go, eh. So I was like, because they didn't have to do that. You know what I'm saying?
Gee, yeah. Stop.
I remember those days.
Atlantic City.
Yeah. Gee, go. Ignore him, G.
Oh, man.
Yeah. When's the last time you spoke to 50 physically or on the phone?
We DM, like, Instagram, a few weeks ago. I would go back and forth on DM and she like, yo, what's up, nigga? Like, da-da-da. And send him shit, like, yeah. Because there's a, like I said, there's a mutual respect, you know. Last time he was in Arizona, I went to the show, and it was like, I think it was more like an after party, actually. It was in a club. We linked up. That was a few years ago. But, yeah.
It'd be easy. Easy. Nigga don't know Wexton, nigga.
Oh, my God.
But he know be easy, though.
Man, that was a fucking fail. That was bad.
The biggest album. Wexton with the first joint, nigga.
That was bad. Now that's some bozo shit. Now that I can agree.
So
what's Hot Rod doing now?
So with all that, right? So I went back to doing my own thing, my grown man thing, doing loans and shit like that, because I got to keep my money right.
Any more cell phone?
You went back to be a mortgage broker?
Yeah. It was not a broker, but it's like, you know, it's a
banker. That's what you do now?
Nah, I don't do that anymore. So now I'm running my Instagram. I'm working with artists. You know what I'm saying? So shouts to K Loud, Rita Real. So I got a couple artists I'm executive producing. And so I got back into that. I had to quit my job because it was like basically like, I was like, the job thing was the secure way, but still my heart's not in that. Like, I shouldn't be sitting behind a desk talking to white people all day that I don't want to talk to.
Oh, Lord.
And not, well, not, you know what I mean? Not like that, man. God, that came out wrong. I'm not.
Until she wanted. You danced with that kid, 250 Cent danced with.
Yeah. Yo, Keenan.
Shout out to Keenan.
Yo, shouts to Keenan, man. Yo, he was super tiny. Yeah, so I started monetizing like my Instagram, working with these artists, and I'm just, I wanted like.
And you're the owner of Hoodville. Hoodville.
Nah, wait. What Hood? What you know about? What you know about Hoodville?
What you know about it?
It's cool. It's like, yeah, it's popping.
Huh?
It's popping.
What do you have to do with it, sir? We on to you.
It's a popping ass page, like, you know.
What do you have to do with it?
Nothing. It's cool. I just, you know, I just fuck with it. Like, it's like one of my favorite, you know.
What are you playing with your hat for?
Just probably the most unsure I see him in these this time.
Nah, like that. Nah, it's cool. It's a cool page. Like, it's hella funny. Like, nobody knows who, like, runs it and all that, but it's just, man, it's cool. It's funny. It's like a funny-ass page. But, people keep trying to, whatever. It's cool. It's a funny page, right?
I don't answer questions unless you answer questions. You better be easy. That stupid shit. What the fuck was that?
About to hit 7. I think we had 7 million.
Oh, you said we at 7 million. Yes.
The page.
You said we. Are you part of that?
Nah, it's just cool. Like, I just like my.
Interesting.
My page is Good Times Jackson, right? Yo, they fuck with my page, man. They deleted my shit yesterday. I gotta appeal it.
Man.
But
did you delete your Instagram yesterday?
Yeah.
Why?
I don't know. Good times. Look, bring it up. So now I got my backup. This is Good Time Jackson 2.0. But, the rumor is that, you know, that I run Hoodville, but, you know.
Did you erase your page to run Hoodville? Nah.
They just deleted my shit. I don't know why, but I got to figure that shit out. But yeah, but nah, the Hoodville, you know, shout out.
What is it called? Curtis Jackson? No, that's 50.
No, good times. Good times, Jackson. But nah, shout out to the Hoodville family. You know what I'm saying? Shout out to.
You got 2.0?
Yeah, that's my backup. They deleted my shit yesterday.
How long? What did you post?
Huh?
What did you post?
I just post fun, you know, I just post funny shit.
What was the last, I hate when niggas do this. Oh, God. What was the last thing you posted, man? God, leave. What was the last thing you posted to make them delete it, bro?
But I don't know if it was that. It was, the last thing I posted was like, it was this Queen, this big, like, Queen Latifah set it off, like, like thick, so like a female Queen's flip.
Mm-hmm.
And it was like a. Fine. A little skinny nigga there, and he walked up, or she walked up to him and like kissed him on the lips like this, and he looked disgusted, and I put when you're in a relationship that you don't want to be in or something. That was the last thing I posted, so I don't know if that was it. You know what I'm saying? But it was hella funny. It was like getting hella views and all that, but. I don't know, man.
Did you have them in, you know, are you on the reviewing stage?
Yeah, so I verified my phone number, and then they said like in 24 hours once they confirm it or something, then I'll be able to appeal it to go on the review. So I'm not there yet, but right now it just says thanks for submitting your information. We'll get back to you in 24 hours. And it's been over 24 hours. So I don't know what they're doing.
Cool.
So
gotta be easy.
But yeah, hopefully when this shit come out, I got my page back. You know what I'm saying? But yeah, shout out to the Hoodville family, man. Hoodville family's amazing.
Shout out to the Coli.
Shout out to the Coli. Yep. The Coli. Coli's amazing. What you know about the Coli? You know about the Coli?
I don't answer questions unless somebody answers them.
Yo, niggas be lurking on the Coli, man. Niggas be lurking. Nobody wanna admit to it. But, you know, this is some Coli shit. GMB. Shout out to GMB.
Shout out to the Coli. The last thing G-Money said, so you working with an artist, you got monetized, and now your shit is disabled. So what we doing next?
Man, I don't know, man. I don't know what I'm going to do.
Have you ever thought about recording again? Or you gave it up?
Yeah. Like, I still write. But now, like, with my artists, so we're like, with K-Loud, it's K-A-J-L-O-U-D, and Read a Real, we're about to put out. So I'm executive producing those projects. So the Read the Real, that EP is coming out on May 18th and whatnot. So that's like giving me my music feels, you know what I'm saying? Like getting in the studio with them and working with them. Because they're young artists, you know what I'm saying? So I'm working on that, and I don't know, man. I don't know.
I hate that record.
Me too, nigga.
The fuck,
yo.
Oh, what? My God.
Who do you like down music?
Who I like?
Yeah.
Yeah, you know X, nigga.
Yo, I like. You know, obviously, you know, the Drakes and the, you know. I don't know about, like. Like I like these South records, but only in, I can't listen to no. Like I gotta be at the club or something. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Like,
what's in your playlist though? Like, if you had to choose, like, if you driving in the car on the way home, like what do you play on your?
It's gonna be Drake, Future, Young man. Ma, nigga. Like, come on, man, she's so good. Young Ma don't get hurt. Young Ma is hella good, nigga. Like, she's. Like amazing. Like, I get, like, I'm like, she's so good. Like, it's effortless too. Like the way she spit, like her production choice, like her wit, you know what I'm saying? Her like, it's just so good. You know what I'm saying? I think she's better than everybody. You know what I'm saying? Not, you know, better than 99% of niggas.
I got you. Are you married or anything? Any children?
Nah.
Nothing, not married, no children.
Mm-mm. No. It'll happen when it's supposed to happen. Like I don't believe in time.
Respect.
You know what I'm saying? Like,
do you want children?
Yeah, I do. That was a shady, huh? You know, like when your pitch go up, yeah, like that was shady. That was shady because
you ain't fixed that issue yet.
Yeah, I'm following up with you on that.
Got to talk to your father.
Yeah,
that's better be easy. That's some bullshit, man.
Yo,
that record was
a shady. It was shady. It was cool. Yeah, that was bad. That was bad.
I respect anybody who can, you know, take accountability for
hype him, G.
The situations, man. You know,
it's true.
God, they about to. G, stop. Don't show love, G. No, you don't deserve it. G, don't show love, G. He don't deserve it, G. You don't deserve it, G. Please. G, no.
He cool, man.
G.
Ah!
G. Ah! He's not good, G.
He's good in my book, man.
Nigga.
Oh,
Dino.
Nigga.
Dino. Ignore it. Ignore it, G.
He's good in my book, man.
Oh, Dino. Oh. Dino.
My book, man.
Hey, I love you, G.
Yo, all the time.
Gino! All the time, G, man. Sit down. Ignore it. No more, G. G, no more.
The box is still open over
there. G!
It's still open.
Oh, G.
Oh!
See it? Ah, damn. Come on, man.
G!
I kind of old on one from earlier, too. I'm a chill, man.
Hey,
what's
man.
Yo? Hey, man. Say it, man. I'll leave it just in case.
Hey man, this was good, man. Like you started off on some therapy shit, and then you brought it back around at the end. Like, this was a really good experience, man.
We appreciate you.
I thank you.
We appreciate you coming up here and telling your story.
Thank you for sharing your platform, man. Thank you. I really appreciate it. I really do. This is like, man, I couldn't ask for more.
I have one more question. You don't have any ill will towards 50.
Mm-mm.
You're not like everybody else. Salute.
Nah, it's a part, like, he's a good nigga.
Solid.
Mm-hmm. He's a good nigga. Like, he shared a lot of knowledge. Like, he, you know, it just didn't work out. You know what I'm saying? But, like, it didn't work. You know? It wasn't like, fuck that, he didn't do this and he didn't do that. Like, you know, we got to hold the steering wheel. We got to make sure we hold the steering wheel. Like you said, accountability. And it's better that way. Like, everything's your fault, like the good and the bad. You know what I'm saying? So that's the way, when you maneuver like that, now you're not a slime ball. You don't have shit, you know, pent up. You're not giving off negative energy. All you can do is just respect the situation and keep it pushing. So 50 was, yeah, he's amazing. Like, I have zero bad to say about that man. Zero.
That's real.
Yeah.
Were you in the office that time when he told everybody to look down at the sneakers that they had on their feet?
Yo! Was that the New Year? I think that was New Year's. New Year. Or right before New Year. Let me tell you some other shit. Quick story.
Sure.
Let me tell you, just be yourself, right? That's the moral of the story. Now, Christmas, this is like that first Christmas, I think it was. So it was like 06. It was either 06 or 07. And, you know, Christmas coming up, it's Christmas. And me, I'm an old, like, text, you know, Merry Christmas. I'm like one of them niggas, right? I remember I go to text 50. Merry Christmas, right? I start typing and I go, oh nah, he don't want to, you know, nah, that's, I don't want to do that. Like, that's kind of whack. You know what I mean? I ain't going to text him. You know, that's kind of soft. You know, whatever my head was saying. So I don't send the text. And I believe this was that meeting. So we had the meeting, talking about that shit. In that same meeting, he goes, yeah. Because it was kind of like he was just saying how ungrateful everybody is. He was like, yeah, Christmas go by. Don't nobody send me no. I remember he was saying that. I remember I just put my hand down. I was like, you know what I mean? Like, it was just funny. He was like, nobody text me no Merry Christmas, nigga. Like, y'all. He was just going in on us. Like, you know, you could tell he just felt like he was doing a lot and then people weren't really respecting his grind. Like, at one point, he felt like he was working harder for us than, you know, we were working for.
So you remember that time in the office where he told everybody, look at the bottom of their foot?
Yeah, because I remember Banks had on some Gucci, some low top. I don't know if they're all black or some brown joints, but I remember he had on some Gucci's. I don't know. I forgot what Yale and them had on. But here's the thing. They were getting, I wasn't getting paid for that was some G-Unit sneaker deal that they already did from a couple years ago or whatever. Mm-hmm. And they were getting a salary or $100,000 a year or something crazy to wear G-Unit shit. So, I mean, he wasn't talking to me. I wasn't getting shit. So, but yeah, I remember that.
No, for real. No. He flipped out. Everybody was in that office, right? It was Yayo, Mob Deep.
Everybody was in there. I don't know. Was Mom in there? I think it was it was like one of the meetings, like where everybody was there. The staff. Because then, remember, and then him and Shaw Money, remember that relationship started getting a little shiesty. You know what I'm saying? And I think because Shaw Money was doing his management thing, but he was still, I think he was still the president. So he was getting like this big ass check. You know what I'm saying? They had a little rift between them, you know, through some shit. So a lot of shit started to, you know, kind of unravel.
I'm getting ready to go listen to Winks in the car.
I'm listening to it too. remember back in the day?
Stop. You can't get another one.
It don't get no realer than that, man.
Yo, remember back in the day, you used to had to write the words down. I need to write the words down.
Gee, ignore it.
I used to print that shit out the library. I used to go print the words out.
Yeah. Gee, don't relate.
Just read line by line.
Gee, don't relate. Don't relate.
I would have did a lot of the same things he did, man.
Gee, do not relate.
Come on, man.
We're not related.
Be quiet, man.
Come on, man. Man.
Got one more. Yeah, just sweet. So, you got any more questions?
Don't relate. Why you put your pinky up like that when you drink?
I don't know.
You know why he did that?
No, it's because the
G!
You know why he put the pinky up?
G, don't say it.
You want me to tell you why he did
that? No!
Because he told me already before.
What he told you?
He said, yo, he cool, man.
G!
He put
the
pinky up.
G, what the
fuck? You cool, man. That's what you gotta do when you cool, man. G! When you cool, you put the pinky up, man.
Give us social media and stuff.
Well,
she wanted it. I could tell she wanted
it. And my Instagram is Good Times Jackson. Good Times Jackson. Hopefully, again, when this come out, I get my page back. Okay. But my backup is Good Times Jackson 2.0. Twitter is Official Hot Rod. And I think that's all I use.
Okay.
Yeah. So, yeah, follow me, man. It's a pleasure. It's a pleasure.
Round of applause one time for the boy Hot Rod, man.
I said, nigga, too. I'm trying to get him out of here, too.
Are you really?
He tells a story. He tells a good story. I wasn't bored at all.
Nah, it was good. It was good. He makes our job a lot easier back over here.
He does, and we're editing.
Right. Yo, man, shout out to the boy Hot Rod. Dope episode. Make sure y'all follow the pages.
Yeah.
At Flip the Script Pod, at Queens Flip with a Z, at DJ G Money Official. Picky Eater Season 4 is out now. Your episode is out now. Did you watch it yet? We didn't watch it yet.
I just shared it.
I saw it, but you didn't see it yet because you had the shows today and everything. So
yeah.
Watch it later on. It's cool. You know what I'm saying? But,
One second. Let me just.
Yo, why you do it? And you put the wallet back. Yo, that's disrespectful. Yo, G, why you just keep the wallet out?
Someone's like, oh, I don't want to. That's too much flexing. I don't really move like that, man. You know what I'm saying? You can't just ride around to your job with the rims on the thing. That's how I get.
Oh, my God.
Yeah,
How you cool, G? G cool, G. Oh, you remember that?
Y'all some old good memory having ass niggas.
It's a good story. So, pardon me as I read the sponsors, guys. So, shout out to today's sponsors, man. You know, popular loner underscore brand on Instagram. Dope clothing brand. I got the, you know what I'm saying? Nice little full little situation here, man. Shout out to KK's Collection, Katie's Corner, the whole team. Appreciate y'all, man. Third time around sponsoring. I appreciate it. Yeah, follow the page, man, at popular loner underscore brand. I got to do that, too.
That was a shady call.
You know what I'm saying? All right.
Finish. It's Queens Flip, man. Shout out to Basky. Shout out to Michelle, Mighty Two Time. Basky. Nah, I don't say that anymore.
Basky the truth.
Shout out to Basky.
Basky the truth. Shout out to Basky.
Shout out to the family. I had enough of you, man. We try to get about that. Shout out to JR. Shout out to Smooth.
Yeah.
You know, flip the script. We here, man. Dope episode. Remember, lock your doors, close your windows, close your blinds, open your blinds. And if you see a nigga like hot rod on your lawn, put it away. He don't mean no harm, but don't let him in because he'll dance on your night floor all night long. I'm from Queens.
What the nigga?